Now entering Nerdist.com. When you were young and your
heart was an open book.
Hold on. You used to say,
live and let live. That's true. Mm. Mm-hmm. I know I did. But in this ever-changing world in which we live in, makes you give in and cry. Sometimes it does.
Yeah.
So live and let die.
Good advice.
Welcome back to the James Bonding Podcast.
Your semi-regular dose of James Bond news.
We're doing what we can, and we're back. We're back with energy, style, panache. We're reborn from the ashes with the Roger Moore years. We've got Paul F. Tompkins in here today.
Hello, I'm back.
Welcome back to the program, Paul.
Thank you for having me back. I'm very excited.
Paul, of course, joined us for the inaugural episode, Doctor No.
Of course I did.
Yeah.
And I feel like this is the inaugural of the Roger Moore movies.
I don't even
feel like that. It's true.
Yeah.
And welcome.
And this is a favorite of yours, right, Paul?
Yes, it is.
It's a favorite of mine as well.
I think this is the first James Bond movie I ever saw.
Ooh. We are now in the year of my birth with this. It's 1973.
What does it matter to you? That's
where the song loses me.
Linda Eastman wrote.
You're not even giving her the McCartney name. You're just calling her Linda Eastman.
Oh, we can't. Linda Eastman Kodak. She didn't just have a mullet. She had a special kind of mullet. Do you guys remember?
Yeah, of course.
Like Scottish warrior kind of mullet.
It was before mullets were a thing,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Like David Bowie and Linda Eastman Kodak had a mullet that...
It was a golden age of androgynous hairstyles.
And she didn't have... She had really light eyebrows, and David Bowie would shave his, and so just things... You didn't know where you were.
Business in the front, key party in the back, because it was the 70s.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, guys, it's good to be back. I'm excited to be in the Roger Moore times.
You are genuinely excited, because I would describe your enthusiasm for the Pierce Brosnan movies as a lack thereof.
Yeah, enthusiasm, you can't even use that.
It really took a lot out of you, I could tell.
It did.
Yeah.
I also watched the Thomas Crown Affair recently.
Right.
Which TCA?
The one? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, TCA reboot.
Not the Steve McQueen Thomas Crown Affair.
It didn't hold up for me as much as I remember. I really remember liking it.
Liking that too.
Yeah, I don't know why.
You've probably seen it more recently than all of us. Well, obviously you have.
Yeah, just said.
What about it? Did you find not holding up?
Yeah. Gosh. I'm going to hold your feet to the fire on this one.
Gosh. Let me just press pause.
Watch
on
your
this.
Fake language.
Was it Dennis Leary again?
No. Was he in that movie?
Yes,
yeah.
He is.
He's completely black. He's locked that out. Wow. Wow.
Good question. Who did the score to it? It has a really odd but interesting score.
Danny
that's
Elfman.
Like jazz or something.
It's not always Danny Elfman.
I don't know. I honestly haven't come prepared to defend this.
We're not asking you to defend it. We're just asking you your thoughts.
I'm just real defensive about the Brosnan era. We got through a hard time.
Oh, of movie making?
She's not describing his career now.
Any movie.
No, just our era of the podcast. Yeah. It was a tough time for us all. For me watching them and for the listeners dealing with me watching them.
Sure.
And then me dealing with their vitriol on Twitter.
Yeah, they weren't happy with your opinions.
Well, some of them were. Some...
May I say this? Yeah. As a guest.
Yeah,
no,
please.
This is
no,
your
please,
house.
Paul.
I'm
yes,
a guest
please.
Here in your
speak
home.
Speak as an objective
Those
distance.
People could go fuck themselves.
Are you listening? Are you listening?
Here's what I would say. If you have any complaints, see the podcast Bursar for a full refund.
It will come out of our paychecks.
Yeah, fuck you.
Hey, Paul.
Yeah, hi.
That was great.
Can we just pull that and have that whenever?
I'm just saying, everyone, can we have some perspective?
Yes.
Let's just keep some perspective on things.
The best part is that you're dressed in like a tracksuit, and I feel like you're just this
don't tell
English
people that.
They thug.
Don't I'm under the weather. We're in the midst of moving.
I love it. I feel like you're an enforcer out to protect us.
I have to get a suit made out of sweatpants material.
That sounds comfortable.
So I can look like me all the time.
Oh, you should, but amazing. With those little stripes down the sides.
I know. I could not look less like myself.
Oh, that's great.
I'm not wearing my Paul F. Tompkins costume.
No, that's great. You've got an Irish hat, right? Is that Ireland?
No, this is the flag of the city of Philadelphia.
Oh, jeez. It's green and
it's
yellow.
Very green.
Yeah. And then you got the Celtic cross.
I do have a Celtic cross. That's a little bit more Irish. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And then the what do you call that? That wedding ring. It has a name, right? The Irish wedding ring.
That's true. The clada.
That's it.
Clada,
yeah.
Ring, yes.
Clada.
And for those wondering and want a full picture of it, it's a jacket by Adidas.
Oh. Adidas. Yes, here's what I did is I took a patch and I put it over the Adidas.
Oh, really?
Oh, nicely done.
Yes. Oh.
I'm wearing the Adidas Gazelle, which is the Daniel Craig workout shoe of choice.
No, I know.
In Skyfall.
Oh. Everyone knows that. Yeah,
what was your Adidas versus Puma thing?
Oh, that's right. Because Adidas, when we were kids, stood for All Day I Dream About Sex.
Yes, yeah. Of course.
Oh, shit. I can't remember what Puma was. We came up with the...
with the acronym.
Yeah. Oh, please understand my something. Oh, God damn, Matt, why?
I'm sorry.
It's going to haunt me.
I bet Mark would remember. We'll text him.
Yeah, we'll text him. Mark McConville. Right.
And Fila was finally a left Adidas, correct? That is the...
Oh, because they split?
Yeah.
Oh, they were brothers, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, it's so sad.
And Nike was, no, I know a lot.
What?
Spelled wrong correctly.
Bad grammar.
Elot.
They're from New Zealand.
Matt, quick check-in. How are you? I haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah, it's been a bit.
We've been real busy.
Yeah, we've been very busy. I've finally gotten over the cold.
Yeah.
So there will be no coughing on this episode.
Okay.
Unless it's from me, because
fair enough.
My
you're starting.
Will not go
you're
away.
Just starting it.
No, I've been on the last day of a cold for a good 5 days now.
Well, 3 weeks. I was 3 weeks out with this thing.
Too long. Like, too long.
Did you miss any work?
That's a fortnight plus half a fortnight.
I missed... his math checks out. I missed 1.5 days of work.
Oh, man.
Because they sent me home on a Thursday.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Ooh, sent you home.
Sent me home. Because it's like, you know, you don't want to get the entire writing staff.
Did they send
you
home?
Well, you did, but they didn't want you to.
Were you telegraphing it a little like wearing fingerless gloves?
No.
May I put more coal in the stove?
Guys, I'm going to bring this barrel in here. Now, don't worry. What's going to happen next is I'm going to light a fire. It's going to be very safe. I always, whenever I think of the homeless man over the barrel, I just think of the beginning of the Randy Newman video for I Love LA.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. As one would.
Ironic song.
Well, listen.
We're back.
Everyone,
ready. Roger Moore's here. Jump. We're excited.
How about a QCI with Matt Gourley? Good check-in.
Oh, yeah, sure.
How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. I've been fighting a real battle with my universal remote control at home.
I heard about this a little bit last night.
To the point where my girlfriend... We were driving last night and said, "Hey, honey, I don't. No offense, but I think you're a little obsessed over this," and it's true.
What?
This in the car?
Yeah.
This was not while it was happening.
It was like I need to set a time to talk
this
to you.
Carried
impacting
into,
your lives
yes,
so much.
Yes. But listen to me.
What's going on?
Well, we all have our things, right?
Yeah.
Sure.
So we got this new TV, and then our old receiver wasn't really working very well with it. We couldn't get proper home theater sound. And I think the listeners will agree, if you're going to watch a James Bond movie, you want it in the best quality home theater experience.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
So I went and got a new receiver, which I didn't intend to do. And then there's 6 remotes. And all of them will do one thing for another thing, but none of them will do all for one.
Yes.
It's like, it's pure capitalism with these remotes.
It's almost like you need a remote for the remote.
I'm getting to that.
I'll see you guys later.
Get back in here.
Paul Tompkins, ladies and gentlemen.
He's really leaving.
He retired from show business that day.
Anyway.
Bought that island.
Long story, exciting. And just as long as it needs to be.
Yeah.
I got a smart app remote control.
Hang on.
No. Try to stop me right now. I'm going to kiss
smart
talking.
App. So what you're saying is now your telephone.
It comes with a remote, but you can also on your telephone, your iPad, just Jonathan Price in Tomorrow Never Dies.
You should have spoken to me.
Why?
Because I have a device that I don't use anymore.
What?
That is
the
Harmony Smart One Touch.
For fuck's sake.
You should have I wish I had known about your problems.
I can take it back.
Take it back. I have the smart touch, you know, the hub that then turns your everything
Why
into
don't you
thing.
Use it?
Because I then got the remote.
Wow, this is like the gift
Guys,
of the Magi for I don't give a shit.
Welcome to Remote Talk.
Oh, anyway, our wireless is for shit and otherwise. Victory is in my sights. Okay.
I just want to come over and program it for you.
Please. It's look, I'm being objective. It's not that I'm inept. It's that the equipment I'm working with.
You're working with the Pierce Brosnan of equipment.
Yes! And give me some classic wood grain from Micah, Roger Moore era.
Yeah.
Oh, stereo equipment with steel fronts. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
Knurled steel knobs and just a Knurled. Toggle switch.
I feel like it'd be copper, judging by his kitchen decor.
Whatever. Let's get into this.
Let's get into this.
Live and Let Die, 1973. Guy Hamilton.
God, this is an all-star. This is an all-star yeah. James Bond situation. You got Guy Hamilton directing. You got Peter Lamont doing some co-designing on this thing. You got Mankiewicz. Yeah, I believe he's a co-production designer.
Really?
I don't remember who the other production designer is, but Mankiewicz on the script again.
Sure, sure.
Three editors for this movie, which I found interesting.
Yeah.
Apparently, it took a lot to cut down those alligators.
Yeah.
Crocodiles. Sorry.
Both. It was both.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Sure, sure.
Like a round mouth. Round nose.
But yeah, George Martin doing the music score. You know, George Martin, of course, for those listening, of the Beatles production fame.
One of many Fifth Beatles.
Yes, one of many Fifth Beatles.
Billy Preston.
There's a lot of
George
Fifth
Martin.
Beatles.
Murray the K.
Fanny nice. Flagg.
Linda Eastman Kodak.
Oh. Patty Boyd Harrison.
Theodore Roosevelt.
Swear to God.
Done and done.
Redirect.
Bagger Vance.
So this is legendary Bagger Vance. So let's
well, we've lost
let's set the stage. Let's set the stage for where we are with the James Bond series.
Mm-hmm. Let me say this.
Yes.
If your ideal James Bond movie features countless black men narrating Roger Moore's movements into CB radios. This is the movie for you.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And it turns out that's what I wanted.
Yeah. You didn't even know.
No, I didn't know that.
Until you saw it.
Oh, my goodness.
I can't explain why this has always been one of my favorites. In fact, for a long time, this was my favorite.
It's a really fun movie.
Yeah. It is.
It's a really fun movie.
Yeah.
There's certain things that don't hold up so well.
Sure.
But I mean, given its time... It's surprising how much of it does hold up.
Yeah.
Like there's great sequences in this movie. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And they put a lot of it's putting him in a strange place that he's never been before, and
that place is called Harlem.
Yeah. Right. New Orleans, Harlem, Jamaica. Yeah, it just doesn't feel like a Bond movie in some ways, but in a good way.
The New Orleans set piece, very interesting how that came about. I rewatched the Inside Live and Let Die. And it's just Guy Hamilton talking about how much he enjoys jazz.
Yeah.
And then someone said, you should check out New Orleans.
Yeah.
And then they're like, well, what can we do there? We can't do Mardi Gras. Like, well, check out these jazz funerals. And he's like, okay, but we can't do 4 minutes there. They're not going to send everybody. Well, you got to figure something else out. What else do they have?
That's right.
They have levees.
Isn't
a boat
also
chase.
Isn't it also how Putter Smith became...
Hold on a second. What? This guy sounds like he has an incredible vision. I like jazz. You got to check out New Orleans. Why? What's there? Do they have jazz there? The word didn't get out that to Guy Hamilton, New Orleans is kind of a jazz town. What's interesting about New Orleans? Go ahead. Dazzle me.
Of all the directors in those inside commentaries, he's my least favorite.
Really?
Yeah, just because the way he sits like this and he's got a real
His
attitude.
Jowls are amazing.
Yeah, well, he can't rival Peter Hunt, though. Those jowls. That's just neck. That's not jowls.
You can't consider him in the jowl category.
No, they do not cross over.
Let's go to the chart.
All right.
So this is right after Diamonds Are Forever.
Yes.
Which was that made a
another
shit
Guy Hamilton
ton of
joint.
Money. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I said, Guy, come
and
on back. Sean's not coming back, but you can come back. And then they worked on Live and Let Die, which was actually Tom Mankiewicz's choice. They said, here you go. Pick one.
Probably because blaxploitation films were hot.
That's what he was into.
Yeah.
He wanted a bunch of black people in the movie, which I was all for. Because it was, you know, of the time, that was sort of what was happening in cinema. So they said, let's do it. But then they were like, oh, but we have to make them all villains. And then they're like, well, listen.
We'll give
everybody who's not James Bond is a villain.
We'll give one CIA part to a black guy, Strutter.
Strutter was great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like Strutter a lot.
I always like the guy that got killed.
Yeah, I always like the guy that helps James Bond.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
Do you know who I don't like in this movie is that particular Felix Leiter who was in a
David
couple,
Hedison.
Right?
Yeah.
His favorite, right?
He's my
your favorite.
Really?
Yeah. Well, next to Jeffrey Wright.
I find him, I don't know if he's still alive. Please
he
don't.
Is. Yeah, oh, I see.
Well, then I'm not going to say
Well, he came to Alex
I don't need
Theater.
The Twitter snitches.
Twitter's
I doubt the he's on Twitter. He came to the Alex Theater here in Glendale. License to Kill.
Let's back this up for a second. Yeah. We're not here in Glendale. We're in Los Angeles.
Oh,
I don't want people
heart.
Thinking I'm in Glendale.
Oh, Matt Myra. I'll have you know Glendale's up and coming. They have a 5-star cinema there where you can sleep.
Oh, you're obsessed with that.
You are obsessed with that.
All I want to do is pay to take naps. Where can I do it?
I want to pay exorbitant fees to take naps and have cocktails brought to me that I won't drink because I'll be sleeping.
Congratulations, you are a true white adult male.
He came to the Alex Theater and he spoke. Anyway, he's taller than you think.
Good to know. What other insight do you have for us, Matt?
Well, that's it. He played two Felix Lighters, and then he got chomped
well,
up.
Well, he played the same Felix
Lighter
twice.
Oh, and he'll be back-to-back.
Yeah, we're going to see him.
Yeah.
Ooh, because
little
of the way
continuity.
We go, we're going to go
next
see
is License to Kill, where he's, All right, so you don't like this guy.
No, I find him uncharismatic.
Who's your favorite Felix Leiter, Paul?
I might not have one.
What?
I think when I was a kid,
I think I liked
Jack Lord probably.
Yeah, Jack Lord. I think Jack Lord's great. He's super charismatic and Jack Lordy.
Right.
But I think I had affection for him because of Hawaii Five-0 because I recognized him from another thing.
You know who's closest to Felix in the book is the guy from Thunderball, the blonde haired.
Okay.
Oh, maybe I liked that guy the best.
Yeah. He reminds me of just like some kind of yacht rocking dude.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Lives on a boat, Hawaiian shirt.
I don't love the Goldfinger Felix Leiter.
Keck Linder?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Older gentleman. older little guy.
Keck. Doesn't that sound like a name Jeremy would make?
What about Jeffrey Wright?
I like Jeffrey Wright. But...
quite possibly the most underrated and underexposed actor of his caliber and generation.
He never speaks the same way twice.
Terrific in Boardwalk Empire.
He's great in Boardwalk
Empire. Terrific in Boardwalk
Empire. He's
great. Empire. Tennessee's.
Yeah, I think he's great in, I get a lot of flack for this, I think he's great in Shaft, the remake.
Oh, haven't seen
Samuel Jackson. He plays
People's
Hernandez.
Peoples?
Oh, Peoples Hernandez.
Mario Van Peoples Hernandez.
Up with Peoples Hernandez?
Oh, they really get the youth motivated.
That's right.
Trevor, what's his name?
Terrence Howard?
What are you going for? Oh,
boy. Taylor.
Swift?
No. Oh, my dad loves the movies.
Taylor Momsen.
Nope. Tyler Perry.
What? My dad loves the movies.
Your dad loves Tyler Perry
movies? Yes. I went to Utah. He lives in Utah. And I went and saw him.
He must have the only copy of these movies.
Matt, you have to see Tyler Perry's Madea's Family Reunion. You have to see this.
You have to see this.
Put it on. You put it on.
It was shot in 48 hours.
48 hours, another one.
It was shot in the background.
Well, that's a good
hours.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. James Bond, Live and Let Die. Cold opening without James Bond.
Mm-hmm.
Is this one of the only ones? Dr. No?
Yeah, Dr. No has it. And
anytime there's people of color involved, we can't have James Bond in the cold open.
No, not at all.
It's in his contract. Now, Roger Moore was previously approached to do Bond.
Mm-hmm.
But he was wrapped up in The Saint. Is that right?
Yeah. I also really, really enjoy the Roger Moore telling the story of how he knew Cubby. He's just like, we loved gambling.
Yeah.
So we would always be gambling across from each other.
Now, Cubby originally didn't want Roger Moore.
Why is that?
I don't know. But then they became fast friends and were always together.
Well, I think we're...
Dear old Cubby, we'd see each other across the gambling table.
We're on record with this podcast as being we're Roger Moore fans.
Big fans
of Roger Moore.
Yeah.
So much so that I believe he's our favorite, correct?
Well, I think Daniel Craig's my favorite.
You can't have the current guy be your favorite.
Why?
Because you need a little distance.
No, I'm saying I understand that thinking and that with that understanding he's still my favorite.
All right.
Like I know that this isn't just a timeless, fresh face pick for me. I'm in.
Whoever's next is gonna be your favorite.
No, because Brosnan was not my favorite during the Brosnan era.
You had some your own issues during that time period.
But you know what? It's almost like it gets into a Doctor Who thing of like there are distinct eras of this.
Yeah.
And the Daniel Craig ones are definitely a reboot of the franchise.
Yeah.
And so he's I think you can say he's your favorite, but
thank you.
Knowing that there's going to be somebody after him and yeah. this thing is going to keep going and mm-hmm. you're going to, as it progresses, you're definitely going to divide it into these two eras. So
yeah. Yeah.
Roger Moore is your favorite of the original.
Yeah. And I'm prepared to not like the next one.
You're already on board, not liking a train.
But Roger Moore, I don't understand how people don't like him. I guess it's the older generation coming off the heels of the Connerys, and it just feels too silly to them. But he's so likable to me.
Yeah, he really is.
And somehow smarmy. He can do both. I don't know how he does it.
He's also, I would argue, well, I mean, he's the only, well, him and Craig are the only British James Bonds, correct?
Yeah.
Timothy Dalton's Welsh, yeah. Connery's Scottish,
yeah.
Brosnan's Irish.
That's right.
But it's not much to say he's the most British. That's but he's right. the most British.
Oh, and Lazenby was yeah. what, Australian or
yeah.
something?
Yeah. 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 But he's the most British, and thusly, he'll always win the British off.
That's true.
This one didn't have a British off. There was no scene between a bunch of old British people.
No.
And it kind of bummed me out.
There's
really
one scene with
it.
Him and M, right?
Yep. Yeah, in his house. That was
in
strange, too.
Let's talk about the cold open.
I love this cold open.
So do I.
I forgot all about it, and when I saw it, I was like, oh, that's right. And I remember as a kid thinking this was like this crazy exotic world, you know, and it's really clever and really
and it hooks
it's really
you.
Fun. Yeah, it hooks
does.
You right
it
away.
Hooks you with a good mystery.
Yeah, because you want to know what the hell's happening. Yeah. And the New Orleans stuff, that funeral thing. Listen, I get it. I get that it probably isn't really possible to drop a casket on someone and pick them up. The stopping of the camera really bothers me.
It's a gadget.
Oh, I don't think it is a stop camera.
You don't think it?
No,
I do.
I think the guy holds on, a stuntman. He's like a guy that holds on to a bar in there. I looked for a clip, and there was no clip.
No. I refuse to believe.
Wait, so you're saying they lower the casket over the corpse. Yeah. And then there's a cut?
It looks to me as though there's a cut.
I didn't notice it. Yeah, I think it's a guy holds on. In fact, why do I feel like I remember reading about that or something?
Because you probably did read about that.
In my dreams.
Why do I remember reading about that?
Oh, yeah, it was yesterday when I read about that.
What was I going to say? Oh, the United Nations opening.
Yeah. Oh,
Let's talk about that.
God, I love that. There's ear dynamite.
There's a TNT detonator
for sound. And the guy acting when he taps on his headphones.
He wants to know what's
going
on.
I love that guy.
But also, something I noticed is you cannot.
He almost wins the British off.
Well, you're absolutely correct.
Without even a line of dialogue.
Saying a word.
Oh. Yeah.
But something I did notice is that, you know, whenever you put an ethnic-looking person in front of a country sign, it just feels racist to me.
What are you talking
because
about?
They're always
Uruguay.
They're always going to be wearing like the craziest garb.
Yeah.
There's no good way to do that.
No.
But that is... Chicken
under his arm.
I do love the idea of there being some sort of detonator. Like, what is that doing? You have to power up the sound? Like, I don't understand.
Yeah, because in TNT, you're literally like...
That's what you're doing. You're generating, you're spinning a coil.
Yeah.
That's charging
electricity.
So, like, are you powering up the sound?
But it would make sense if the guy got electrocuted, but he didn't. He just got killed by a frequency.
Yeah, well, it's like the brown note, but opposite.
Yeah.
So we get to see the United Nations, and then we cut to New Orleans, where another gentleman is killed on the street.
Yeah, well, I love that. I love the little guy that kills him.
That's Bourbon Street, correct? I've never been to New Orleans. Well, maybe you can tell me, but is that the same street corner that they're standing on in JFK?
Oh, I don't know.
Right across from the office. All right.
Was that on Bourbon Street?
I believe that his office was. Yeah. Now let's talk about the snake. The ridiculous snake death.
Oh. This is. Is it better or worse than the tarantula from Dr. No?
Well, what's weird is that there is a couple of shots with that same snake, the real snake.
Yep.
And I'm surprised how fake the
real snake
looks.
The coloring
so fake.
Of it
just
insane.
Looks ridiculous. Yeah.
It does. It looks like a child was told to paint what they think a snake looks like.
Yeah. Also, it's really taking its time, the snake. Like, James Bond leaves the room, and the snake's just like, I'm going to stay at this pace.
Did I?
I hope he comes back in here.
Oh, you're talking about in the bathroom?
Yeah.
Oh, we're talking about in we're the talking about cold these, opening, the green and yellow
the
snake.
The green and yellow snake that scares the man to death.
But that, I forgot about that. Yeah. Here's what I love. That guy that's tied to the stake
yes.
looks more just uncomfortable than anything. Just
Baines.
Like,
I rather liked Baines.
Do you,
why?
But do you remember now seeing something also about that gentleman that he actually passed out
oh,
for
yeah,
fear
yeah.
of the snake?
Yes.
He actually
what?
Passed out
in
yeah.
real lifetimes?
Yes.
And that blood they put on him just is just like the wateriest Kool-Aid when he gets bit. You
well,
know
they go two. There's two ways in James Bond movies they go with blood. Ridiculous
yeah,
red paint.
Red, yeah.
Or not quite enough.
Right, right.
Yeah.
There's
yeah.
no happy medium.
Yeah, really. Mix the two, for
oh,
Christ's sake.
I forgot
sake.
About that guy.
Baines. So we go right from Baines dying to seeing, what is the what is that, what is his name? It's not Teehee. It's the other guy.
Oh, Baron Samedi?
Monroe.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yes, Baron Samedi.
The Jeffrey Holder.
Yes. So
seven
we go,
up.
Seven up. Yeah. Cola nuts.
That, by the way, I remember the him terrifying me as a child.
Oh, absolutely.
Really, like, fucking terrified.
He's so great. Yeah. One of my favorite characters in cinema.
But he's wonderful. Now, he's also... He was a big Broadway dancer and choreographer. In fact, he choreographed all of the dance in this whole movie. He's... credited as the choreographer.
Nice.
And he
double dipping on that check.
Yeah. What was it? I don't remember what I was gonna say.
Okay, that's all right.
Good. That's good. That's good.
You know what? You're dynamite to both of you.
We should play that sound.
We should have one of those just set up here at any time when you don't like what someone's saying. You just ear dynamite.
That'd be a fun prop to yeah. own, right?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Let's yeah. look into that. Someone it find was, out. It was someone find out if Dave Mandel bought it.
It was an analog era.
It
don't
was.
Forget.
It was indeed.
Everything yeah. had to be steampunked.
I'd also like to own the genuine Felix lighter.
Oh yeah, yeah.
A genuine Felix lighter.
So good.
All right, so we come in.
I like life.
He does. He
it's
loves
the
it.
Little things.
He's got so much joy for life, that man. And he lives in, doesn't he live in Monte Carlo?
Probably.
Like Roger Moore?
Why wouldn't he?
Probably.
Why wouldn't he?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like to escape taxes, I
they,
think?
Everyone, I feel like any British celebrity doesn't live in England.
Well, it is a ridiculous tax rate.
Oh.
Anyway, we'll talk about this on another podcast.
Ridiculous.
The Labour Party. It's a party about the anyway,
sure.
Treasury bonding.
Well, let's talk about now the let's talk about the theme song, which we have discussed many times already.
Yeah,
Live and Let Die.
But even the fade into the titles mm-hmm. is wonderful. I
yes,
just kind of hey,
hello.
Was that you?
I don't know. Who knows,
guys? Mine's in my pocket. Wasn't me.
Wasn't me.
Check, check, check.
All right, this song
wasn't me.
Have I told this story where? George Martin brought the demo that McCartney, he got McCartney to do the song. He brought the demo into Harry Saltzman and Saltzman goes, I like it. Now who's going to do it? And George Martin goes, you have Paul McCartney. Like, well, who else can we get? And he's kind of like,
who else can we get?
He's not going to do it unless he can do it.
How about Bert Convy?
I think he was thinking like, get some chanteuse or something, which also brings me to that scene in the New Orleans club
yes.
where that woman sings it. I love that person.
That is
too.
That
there's
is
your music. Screw off Guns N' Roses. Give
yeah.
me that lady's
yeah. sure.
version. Oh,
yeah, yeah.
The way she's like just like wrapping her hands around and singing to the
yeah.
him as he goes
it's
down.
A very deep.
I jump
it
ahead,
is a
but.
it is a great Bond theme. It's a great song. Mm-hmm. It's very exciting. It's got that. I love that crazy bridge. You know. I love this song.
Yeah.
The Jamaican
really song.
Reggae bridge.
Yeah, and I haven't seen it. It's been a while since I've seen the movie, so
yeah.
to see it in the context of the titles
yeah.
and everything is, it's perfect.
The song
perfect.
Is so good. It's so
yeah.
good. It's Paul McCartney like 3 years off of the Beatles or 2 years off
in
of the Beatles.
In the best era of the Wings, which is a band that I love probably as much as the Beatles, if not maybe.
5 years, because they split up in
69,
70,
yeah.
right?
They split up in 70.
Yeah.
George Harrison was only 25.
When they split up?
Yeah. Yes.
Insane.
He had done all of that by
That's
the time
insane.
He was 25.
Why did he live so long?
What?
Why didn't he live so long?
Why did he live so long?
What do you mean?
He had a life.
He did die prematurely, sadly. He's my favorite Beatle.
He was everybody's. No. That's the right answer.
I'm saying he overstayed his welcome. I know that's an unpopular
opinion. You got whispery at the end of that. Like, should I be saying
he overstayed his welcome.
Yeah, George is the answer. When everyone asks you,
yeah,
those of you listening at home, someone asks you what your favorite Beatle is, say George. It's George.
Love him.
But yeah, it's amazing. The song is amazing, and to see it with the sort of blaxploitation titles that they have in this, it's different than the Bond movies, and you know,
it's a little scary.
Yeah,
I watched it alone, and I was, I don't know.
When I was scared
of that universal remote. What if it doesn't work?
Next time we podcast, I will have conquered this. We'll all be settled.
I wouldn't say that.
We'll all be settled.
I believe in you.
Thank you.
I don't believe in you,
Matt.
We're into the era. Yeah, so this is the blaxploitation era. When I was a wee lad and worked at Blockbuster, I made it my business to watch every blaxploitation flick we had in stock.
How did that business do?
It did very well. I made upwards of no dollars and no friends. But, you know, I've seen all of these great character actors in many other films, and it was really great to see them in a film with a budget.
Mm-hmm.
In a film where they had... great costumes. By the way, now let's talk about a couple of things. So this movie immediately, so we come out of that and then we go and we see James Bond's apartment.
Mm-hmm.
Townhouse. We'll say it's a townhouse, right?
Sure.
He's doing fine.
Yeah.
He's in a townhouse.
It seems fitting. It doesn't seem too lavish, but it seems, I mean, it's very
I would
modern.
Argue it seems a little, not the kitchen's modern.
Not a window in the place.
Oh, the kitchen's so
the
modern.
The kitchen is.
As we will discuss.
Oh.
The kitchen's
we will
run.
Get.
Well, let's get to the kitchen in a second.
Devoted camera time to show you with no dialogue to show you how modern
let's,
that shit is.
But first, we must. I feel like we should talk about. So he's in bed with an Italian lady.
Yeah.
Who
is wearing? Will be wearing a powder blue dress.
Yes. Again, the Guy Hamilton powder blue rule.
It's every Bond movie powder blue.
So we see her then knock at the door, and James goes to open the door, and it's M.
But already, as soon as he opens the door, M gives a brilliant look.
Yes.
Just this dry, that's your British off right there.
Bernard Lee.
Oh, he's the best.
He really is great. In fact, I was searching for this movie on iTunes, not available.
Not Live available. And Let Die?
Not on
you
iTunes
don't own
right
it?
Now. That's I how, own it. I do well, own it, but I wanted I a copy it. To have. You watched it on iTunes?
Yeah. I had to buy it. It's not rentable.
Oh,
I couldn't find it. I couldn't find
you
it.
You didn't have to do that.
But anyway,
where,
but I
could have couriered one over to you.
I will say that it looks fantastic.
Yeah.
Like they did a great job restoring it.
Yeah.
I was kind of shocked like halfway through realizing this looks tremendous.
Yeah.
They really did a good job.
Since the new TV, this is the first old Blu-ray.
God,
I'm telling you this thing.
Shut up about
whoa.
This TV.
You can every watch programs seconds. On it. Whoa. Do you understand that?
You know what? I'm starting to be on the universal remote side.
You guys heard of Mythbusters? You can just get it on your TV.
Wait.
Yeah, sure.
You can just
no,
get
I'll
it
tell you more.
All
I'll
right.
tell you more. But it looks amazing, and you can see flaws in people's skin like you don't want to. You know?
Oh yeah, yeah.
It's really
you
something.
Sure can. The
I was watching Raiders of the Lost Ark on Blu-ray.
Raiders looks really.
How did they do
really,
that? That's like
really good.
Really shows you what a cinematographer can do.
Raiders, if I recommend it, Paul, if you haven't seen it, watch Raiders of the Lost Ark, the Blu-ray release of
I
it.
I have not seen it on Blu-ray.
Good lord,
yeah.
That movie looks amazing.
Yeah.
Temple of Doom looks okay.
Yeah.
Last Crusade looks amazing.
Uh-huh.
That's it.
But everybody's a little orange in this Live and Let Die. Maybe I haven't calibrated my color correctly, but I'll take care of that.
Get on that.
By next week.
Get on that.
By next
Christ.
Week.
Get on
I'll
that.
Get on. I'll get on it.
Well, let's talk about it. So he in James Bond's apartment, I will say the... I found the choice of painting that he had hanging over the mantle pretty odd.
Yeah.
What was it? I don't remember.
It's an oil painting of some old admiral or something.
Yeah. It's not above his bed?
No. Because his bed is up a couple, and then it's like, of course his bed is low. I feel like, of course, he would have a low bed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It seems like a thing.
Also, the robe he's wearing is wonderful.
The gold robe.
You didn't like
it? Don't like it.
Well, I didn't realize.
Wasn't
it's
it?
Yellow.
I like the
piping, but I don't. I don't like that color.
But the speaking of the Blu-ray, I didn't realize until I watched this that it's damasked. Like it's got that two-tone sheen to it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You're just looking at me, touch my chest. All right.
Monogrammed.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh God.
But doesn't it have a quilted collar or something? Am I thinking of something else? Oh no.
Oh boy.
Raiders of the Lost Ark, he's wearing a robe. That's what I'm thinking of. He wears a quilted collar. Oh, you guys, life's boy, great. Boy.
You need
life's
to great. Just stop.
Been a rough couple of weeks. It's been a rough couple of months with these Brosnans. You know, give me one movie to get back in the spin of things.
All right.
Fine,
all right.
By Man with the Golden Gun.
Okay. Yeah. So for some reason, he feels, well, I guess it's because he was working professionally with this Italian woman. I wasn't quite sure why he was hiding her.
Yeah, I wasn't either.
Yeah. I mean, everybody knows James Bond gets around.
This is still in the time of propriety.
Wait a minute.
One simply doesn't do those things.
Is that maybe M's apartment and James Bond was not supposed to have girls in there?
Oh, I wish.
That's why there's that Admiral painting?
He wouldn't have had that espresso maker or whatever it was.
We saw M's, you see M's house wonderfully portrayed in Her Majesty's Secret Service.
And Casino Royale and Skyfall.
Yeah, but those are two different places. I wish she'd kept the same place. You know what I mean?
Well, when her husband died, she had to, you know, streamline.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about
clearly,
I think
her
our
husband
favorite
was into modern, and then when he died, she's like, finally, I can get back to the old colonial style.
I don't think colonial was a style in England.
It is the style. It's the
everything style.
At the colonial time, it was Edwardian. But anyway.
Whatever.
So let's talk about our favorite thing in the movie, which is James Bond's kitchen.
Oh, my God.
And that coffee maker.
By the way, those copper roosters.
Yes, that seems out of touch. That's country kitsch.
My mother had those in our kitchen.
And
in
those tiles. Those
roosters.
Yeah.
Copper. But then, my favorite part is there's an entire counter full of pots and pans just placed.
Really?
Just I didn't notice. So,
and he's never touched one.
Oh my
except
goodness.
To make scrambled
but
eggs.
Then you're like, that's an awful lot of cookery for one man to have. Mm. And then the stove is full of them. Wow. Like, it is just covered in copper.
Well, maybe it's one of those things. You know how, like, let's say you have like a little, a mug with a crow on it. And it was like, oh, he likes crows.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to get him crow
everyone
stuff.
Gets
so he's like, oh, James Bond has a pot in his house. I'm going to get him a pot for a gift.
He loves pots.
He loves pots and pans.
He's got a Scottish housekeeper named May in the novels that lives with him.
Oh. And doesn't know how to put shit away?
No. I'm not sure if she lives with him, but she's there all the time, cleaning up after him, making meals.
So this...
Yeah.
The Vitamix of its day, I suppose, the fanciest thing you could have. Was apparently an espresso maker.
They treat it like it's a gadget from Q Branch. Is that
they
all it does?
There might as well be a line before he makes the coffee that's like, wait till you see this.
Same with his digital watch in the beginning, too. Like, they really, really devote a little time.
I took a screenshot of the credit. They get a special thanks in the in the credits, and it's the, come on, I have it here. Keep talking while I find
the shot of the watch is so long that I was waiting for something to happen.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, this is a gadget that he has, and then nothing happens. Then I realized, it's just a new thing.
Yeah,
those red digital
pulsar, the time digital computer.
Let me see.
The time computer. It computes the time.
I took the shot because they wanted to thank Rolex Inc., Pulsar, the time computer, and the Black Stuntmen's Association of Hollywood.
Oh, wow.
Really great. Oh, and Tarot Cards by Fergus Hall.
Speaking of both Black Men's Stunt Association and Tarot Cards, when they're in a hotel room in Jamaica and he flips Rosie over, couldn't more obviously be a man.
Was it really?
Oh, God.
I didn't notice.
And she's a muscular broad.
The black stunt woman.
She's a muscular broad?
This muscular broad.
This guy was really muscular. And those tarot cards.
Why are you speaking like Paul's dressed?
Oh, she was a muscular broad.
Chiseled gal.
The deltoids on this bitch.
Oh.
Sorry, that's too hard. Too much.
Did you guys notice the back of those tarot cards there?
007.
Yeah.
You know, you can buy those tarot cards.
I have them.
Of course you do.
Well, someone gave them to me as a gift. All of the
pots.
Yes. Like Matt likes James Bond. I get a lot of James Bond gifts.
I feel like I'm not watching these movies the same way.
No, you're probably not.
I didn't catch those copper roosters.
Thing.
I didn't catch the back of the tarot cards.
You're watching it to enjoy it.
Well, I'm watching it like it's a movie. Not like it's a crime scene to be studied.
He's watching people act, and we are looking right past them.
I want you to know that I'm calibrating my new TV off the powder blue of James Bond's terry cloth onesie.
No terry cloth in this movie.
God damn.
No powder blue terry cloth. A lot of powder blue.
Yeah.
Yep.
No terry cloth at all?
No. That's the one thing I was looking for. Because of your theory. That's the one thing I was looking for.
There has to be. He uses a towel at some point. Done. Done.
So this is when the...
Are there towels in every James Bond movie?
Ooh,
is that the thing that unifies all of them?
Illuminati.
I think there's towels in every film.
Oh, my God.
To be a Mason, ask a Mason.
Bed, Bath, and Beyond.
All right.
Towel theory.
My favorite exchange between Bond and M, which is then became a cliche in all movies, not just James Bond movies, but was, we need you on the next plane. Oh, get me on the next plane to such and such. You're already on it.
Yeah. Oh, it's good.
It's a good exchange.
May I back to the coffee maker?
Yes.
So there's this
we need
dedicated
to devote as much time on this podcast
to this coffee maker.
Yeah.
But then what's so crazy is instantly undercut by M saying, "Is that all it does?"
Yeah.
So I mean, I don't know to be a moviegoer at that time.
Yeah.
How did that line impact? Because watching it from a modern standpoint, it's like, well, yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah.
That, after what we just watched, that's the perfect thing to say.
Yes. Yes.
But at the time, are you like, if you went to see that movie in the theater, would you have said, oh, stupid M?
First of all,
what we just saw was amazing.
I think they're doing
He's grinding his own beans. He's grinding his own espresso beans.
Grinder, yeah.
Yeah.
Huge. Like he's selling coffee beans on the side.
But then he's making M an espresso, not a coffee.
I think they're doing what will become a running joke with the Subway sandwich and then the menthol inhaler in Never Say Never Again, where you think it's a gadget and then you find out it's just a regular everyday object.
This, by the way, gadget heavy movie with no Q appearance.
Why?
I don't know.
Why would they do that?
It's very gadget heavy.
Did they just feel like they had to condense time? That's why M stops by his house
in the middle of the night.
He has a watch. I was on my way home.
And then Moneypenny, too?
Yeah, Moneypenny shows up. It's great.
The whole gang's here.
And she bros.
Everyone except Q.
She bros before hoes him, too.
Yeah, she really does. Yeah. She's a winner, that Moneypenny.
It's just national security, right?
People online were asking me, like, my timeline theory doesn't work because of Moneypenny. But then I say to them that Moneypenny is the adopted daughter of Moneypenny.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
The new Moneypenny. Oh. So that's how that theory works in my head. Now,
follow the terry cloth.
He flies to New York.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Oh, by the way, what he's wearing when he gets off the plane in New York, just that top coat.
Yeah.
Top
coat.
God, he
fits
looks so
like a glove.
Good. Yeah. He's got gloves on.
Super British.
Oh, looks great. Looks great.
We love. Yeah.
I love the style of this movie because it's crazy 70s, but not crazy.
It's not as crazy as you think it's going to be.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
Even with like
the pimp clothes and some of the extras, that's sort of the wacky 70s that you think of when you think of 70s clothing.
It still somehow doesn't go too far, though. It's great.
Yeah, yeah, it's surprising.
Yeah, his suits are all sort of like, I mean, the lapels are a little large, but other than that.
He's clean cut, too. Like
He looks terrific.
He really is fit.
And he's 45, I think, when he did this already.
Wow.
Goodness.
Yeah.
20 years older than George when he quit the Beatles?
Yeah. He's how many years older than Connery just in general? He's a couple, 3 years older than Connery or something like that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
It's so crazy how Connery looks just like...
I know. You take Diamonds Are Forever Connery and Live and Let Die Moore.
Oh, my God.
And they don't even look the same.
You put Dr. No Connery and Live and Let Die Moore and you put them next to each other, you go, Roger Moore's the younger guy.
Put Finding Forrester against Cannonball Run Roger Moore.
I'll do you one up. Put Spice World's Roger Moore.
Oh.
Against the Extraordinary Gentleman Sean Connery.
Yes. The league.
League of, sorry, everyone.
Put getting beat by his wife, Roger Moore, against beating his wife, Sean Connery.
Yeah.
It's just uncomfortable all around, yes. Is that the point
just,
there.
You just perfectly described their bonds.
I know. All right.
Okay. We land in New York.
Yes.
James Bond is picked up in a Lincoln. They're heading down the old expressway there.
Uh-huh.
When what do we see? A pimp mobile.
Whisper in the pimp mobile.
Pimp mobile with missiles.
Oh,
yes.
That are darts.
So great.
With dart missiles. Wow. And a whole targeting system.
This driver, Roger Moore's driver too, is just feels like a non-actor.
Charlie.
Or something like
Charlie.
Yeah.
Oh, the guy with the crazy sideburns?
No, that's his cabbie.
That's the cabbie.
Oh, the cabbie.
This is the guy that picks him up from the airport. He's so nondescript. And
let's get there one piece, shall we, Charlie?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
The only acting he does is slump over.
Oh, I thought that was in a cab.
But
that
it's
was
a very believable. It's a very believable slump, though.
Yeah.
It is. This was a great car chase.
Yes.
It was.
It was really great.
Yeah.
But the pimp
it seemed very novel to me that, you know, having the dead driver and him having to, from the back mm-hmm. seat, navigate the car. I feel like that must have been done in something else, but this seemed very, the way it was shot, it was like very fresh and
yeah, and it also seemed like that's how that would happen.
Yeah.
That's how
it was exciting.
That's
it was
physics
really
of
exciting.
That.
Yeah.
But yeah, Felix Leiter on the radio actually
James.
Says Pimpmobile.
Yes, get me a make on that
get
Pimpmobile.
Get me a make on a white Pimpmobile.
I that was like, wow.
That's just
why?
What they were
called. Come on.
Yeah. It's a good-looking car, though.
But is that a reflection? Is that sort of a commentary on the rudeness of Americans? Like, I would never have described it such.
Well, I think the commentary...
It's written by an American.
The commentary on the American thing is, I think, Sheriff Peppers.
Oh,
who's clearly a British actor,
which
right?
we'll get to. He's actually New York.
No.
He's a New
really?
York actor.
Yeah.
No Southern accent,
Did
but
you
he's a New
think
York
he
actor.
Was British, really?
The Southern guy?
Yeah,
the sheriff?
Yeah.
Because that accent is so terrible.
Yeah.
It's like, this guy must be British.
Yeah.
Like, this is what American people
but
sound
by
like.
By the way, they say in the documentary, I forget who's saying it, they say, like, he's not even Southern. Can you believe the accent? It was so good.
Terrible.
Secret agent.
It's absolutely terrible. And I didn't want to look it up at the time because I wanted to see if I was.
Well,
right.
You know they bring him back in Man with the Golden Gun. Do you
yes,
know that?
Yeah. I do remember that. Yeah.
And he's also
well, why not? He was so much fun.
He's in Superman 2.
Oh.
He plays the same character in Superman 2. He's a sheriff.
Yeah.
That when the three Zod and the two others land, and he's got the like young protege sheriff, and he goes, "You go handle him."
Yeah.
How was everybody convinced that this guy was so good at this?
Well,
because he's awful.
It was that definitely him being in that movie had to be after Dick Donner got shit canned
yeah,
and they brought
yeah,
in
Richard
Lester.
Yeah.
Dick Lester, Dick Donner. Oh my God, guys.
Yeah, who directed Hard Day's Night, Beatles, yes. Paul yep. McCartney, Live and Let Die. We're back.
Okay.
thank you for the breadcrumb trail.
You're welcome. Ear dynamite.
So Bond still has to get to where he's going.
Yeah.
So they trace the Pimpmobile was registered
White
to
Pimp-mobile.
The store. Because, of course, the Pimpmobile's registered to the hideout. That's what you do when you build a Pimpmobile and
well, but it
legally
it's a
register it.
Imagine
it's a
legally
yeah.
register
yeah.
it.
All right.
Both
oh,
of
what do we list as the...
It's a front. It's a voodoo store.
Hey, boss, this is a work car, so you mind if I register it
I want to be able to write off gas.
I feel
are you
like
even
the insurance is a little better
are you
over
even
here.
Hearing me? It's a voodoo store. That's a
it's
front.
Called,
it's a hidden front.
Yes, but it's called O-Cult.
Yeah.
O-H Cult.
Yeah. I'll go to bat for this.
That's not quite as good as Filet of Soul.
Touche.
Which is a better name. That's not a bad name.
Can you gift wrap this lengthwise? What? I didn't understand that.
like a triple entendre?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know what that means.
So James has to get there. So James goes in.
Out.
He sort of takes a gander around,
mm-hmm.
and then he finds he stumbles upon the way to get
to the
Pimpmobile parking lot. Pimpmobile's there. He then has to follow the Pimpmobile, so he hails a cabbie,
mm-hmm.
and this is when we begin our fun network of CB radios
oh.
yes.
hidden all across Harlem.
Yeah,
yeah.
And He says there's an extra 20 in it, and the wonderful driver says, for an extra $20, I'll take you to a Ku Klux Klan cookout.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cookout.
Am I misremembering, or does he actually say Ku Klux Klan? Most people do that, yeah. And they're wrong. Yeah. A little respect.
Respect the Klan, please.
All right, George Harrison died too late, and you respect the Klan. That's what we're getting here. So, okay, he gets to the Filet-O Sol. Mm-hmm. I've checked out.
We can find him. It's like following it.
I've checked out that corner.
Really?
Storefront. Yeah, the storefront still exists.
Mm.
I think right now it's actually a restaurant. Which it wasn't then, but yeah. And the building with the 7-Up sign. That section has not changed.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
It's very, I mean, it's not as filthy. And crime-ridden, as it looked in the movie, but that corner is still there.
To be fair, they put those crimes in there for dramatic purposes.
Right? They had to, because I can't imagine Harlem in 1973 being a bad place.
This is not a documentary.
I love this scene where he goes in to this place, and I'd like it neat, please, no ice.
That'll be extra.
And then when he sits James Bond down, James
put ice in things.
James, it got a lot of energy to take.
I'd like a beer, no ice.
James Bond turns around in the thing, and the guy takes the money and drinks the drink.
Yes,
oh, so
yes.
Good,
smooth. It's great. It's smooth.
Yeah,
and then so this is when we meet Mr. Big.
Yes,
which this must be the first instance of someone named Mr. Big, right?
Sex in the City. This and. And the band.
Don't forget Wayne's World.
I think there was a Mr. Big in the animated the Wacky Racers.
Yep.
The Ant Hill Gang.
Oh, my God.
There's a bunch of tiny guys in a big car, and I think their leader was Mr. Big.
Wow.
They're all connected in some way.
Yeah. Let me ask you guys something with a little bit of the inside Ian Fleming novel knowledge of this film. Mm-hmm. What do you think about Mr. Big's face? Tell me what you think. Just tell me.
Okay.
Okay.
I forgot a thing about Mr. Big that is revealed later. And so when I first see him.
You didn't immediately go, that's Yaphet
Kotto? No, I didn't. I didn't. Not till the next time you see him. And then I was like, oh, right. Before he pulls the face off. Yeah, but when I first see this guy, because you see him, it's a medium shot. They don't have any close-ups
of
him.
Yeah.
And he's in and out pretty quickly.
Yeah.
And I remember that. And so I'm watching it now and I'm thinking, what's with that guy? He looks like a weird bird victim or something.
He looks like the black version of that blonde 80s actor that kind of had burn scars. He was in a lot of like action movies. You know who I'm talking about?
You're
that?
Thinking of Michael J. Vincent? Is that who you're thinking
of? I don't know his name, but let me tell you this. So In the novel, there's just Mr. Big. There's no
Kananga.
That
right.
guy's name. The Kananga character is named after the guy that owns that alligator farm.
Yeah.
For the movie. But in
too good a name to waste.
It kind of
but
was.
It does sound African, and the guy is like a white Southern guy.
Somebody looking over the script, like, can we get Kananga in there somewhere? Just name somebody Kananga.
Ross Kananga is his name. But in the novel, Mr. Big is the villain, and he's really thick and big, and like Fleming goes out of his way to say how thick-skinned black people are in just horrible ways.
Boy.
Yeah. So he has a pulmonary artery problem, and so he's black, but his skin is gray because he doesn't get enough blood, and that's why they never mention in the movie, but Mr. Big is kind of gray.
Yeah.
You know, he looks
he's ashy.
Yeah. And that's why. You've just experienced Fleming Corner.
Now, in the BBC docudrama...
Are you watching it?
I haven't watched
it.
I've got it taped, but I haven't watched it.
Do you think they will include his crazy homophobia and racism?
I hope so.
I would hope. I mean, what built the man.
Yeah, no kidding.
It's bananas. When you read some of those lines, you're like, oh,
he had some problems.
Okay.
Yeah. He had some problems.
He had some problems. They started with drink and ended with horrible racism.
He wrote on a golden typewriter. I mean, that tells you enough right there.
What?
Yeah. He knew how to spend
real?
His money.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
In a blue terry cloth short pant onesie
will
jumper.
Will you stop
I
it?
I will not.
Will you yield?
We need to just get it over with and both wear them.
I'm dying for one of those.
I bet it's comfortable.
Paul, are you in?
I bet it's comfortable.
Are you in, Paul?
Sure.
Right. Oh, yeah. Onesies are never comfortable because if you hunch, like if you do a shrug, like I don't know, and then it really ruins your crotch. You know what I'm saying? It
ruins your crotch for other people.
Like your scenario where you're shrugging them. I don't know.
So I have to. I have
How
to
often
act,
in life do you actually?
I have to act like
you
know I
what?
Know
Hold
everything.
Hold on a second, Matt
yes.
Myra.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. Yes, Paul.
More than you think.
Really?
It's not like you're thinking in your mind. I better give it a shrug here. It's no. like it's a thing that you yeah. do.
You're doing it right now.
Oh!
Oh my God!
Oh, I gotta get out of here.
Point taken.
My girlfriend
Paul,
bought
use
me.
Use your legs. Use your legs.
My girlfriend bought me a onesie sleeper for a Christmas a couple Christmases ago. Yeah. And since wearing it, I cannot say I don't know. I have to lie about everything. I cannot shrug my shoulders. I have to just, she'll ask me a question like, how does nuclear fission work? Well, here we go. And then 3 hours later, I've explained
She's
it.
She's asleep.
Yeah.
And your remote and still doesn't work.
Oh. Oh.
You got to get that crotch lowered. You, like LBJ.
Oh, me
just
or the
for crotch lowering.
Yeah. LBJ, I got to get the crotch of these. What are the brand of the pants?
Oh, I forget. Hager?
Hager slacks, maybe, yeah.
Oh, all right. God, yes. The tape of him.
That for the listener, if you're not familiar, seek out, it's very easily found, the audio of LBJ on the phone with his tailor.
Yeah.
Describing in excruciating detail how he wants these trousers altered.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
And I don't know if that's the same tape, but he has single-handedly the most off-putting quote ever, which is,
yeah.
That's the worst thing to happen since pantyhose ruined finger fucking. Says that on one of his phone conversations.
As he should.
All right. Not to be indelicate after this Lyndon Baines Johnson quote, but segueing into one of my favorite Bond girls. Or you can just do one.
She's no. Lyndon B. Johnson should always be our segue into everything.
He's my favorite Bond girl. Lady Bird Johnson.
Oh, she was something. She was Lady Bird. But yes, Solitaire, Jane Seymour, Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman.
Mm-hmm. She now has her own jewelry line.
Oh, yes, she does. Open heart.
Yeah.
Open heart?
It's called like heart to heart or yeah, leave your heart open or something
Bypass
like that.
Bypass.
It's not. It's this design, which I'm sure you've seen. Here, I'll draw it on my rent check. It goes like this. You know, like that, but not as shitty.
Oh.
And it, you can get it from a jeweler. Now that we've plugged Jane's line.
Yeah.
Maybe she'll come on the show.
Valentine's Day is coming.
Oh, guys, next week. What are you going to do?
That's right.
Solitaire, she's wonderful. Mm-hmm. I think she's great.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for the role. I mean, the role she's playing, they wanted to go, Mankiewicz wanted to go black.
Yeah.
But
he knew he could never go back.
In a wise joke.
And every Bond girl would be black after that.
By the way, there should be. I'm glad Moneypenny is now a woman of African descent. I feel like there's a severe
woman
lacking.
Of African
there's a severe lacking.
Descent. I think you.
Well, you I can't say African American because she's British.
That's true.
Do you even know if she's African? She could be West Indies.
Oh, that's very true.
I don't know, though.
That's very true.
A woman of color.
Naomi Harris.
Yeah.
That's probably what I should have said. In retrospect.
It's an expression that people use.
Yeah.
A shadowy lady of the night.
But it's just so...
A dusky Bantu woman.
A Nubian princess, if you will. I feel like it's something that the series has lacked many times over.
And Halle Berry didn't help much.
No, she did not. She, I would say, set the whole thing back.
No, come on.
The writing in it.
Denise Richards did more to set back things for black women in Bond movies.
However.
What?
Let's talk about Rosie.
Oh, I know.
Because
I know.
It is unfortunate that this is not the first woman of color we've seen in a James Bond movie.
Correct.
Seen, no.
But for someone who's supposed to be kind of a Bond girl and kind of his ally.
And a CIA agent.
And a CIA
yes,
agent.
That's
just
the thing.
Like ridiculously incompetent and cowardly.
Yeah.
And like a woman like this would never have made it into the CIA.
No, it's a fault of the writing.
Never.
For sure.
Yeah, yeah, it's really, yeah. It's and I felt so bad for
on
the
her
actress.
Second mission, no less.
Yeah. I felt so. What was the first mission? Crossing guard?
No, her first mission.
Make sure these kids get across the street safely.
She worked with Baines, the guy who got scared to death by
yeah.
a snake.
Yeah, oh, they were an unbeatable team. two terrified people.
Where are we going to put him? In Jamaica.
We
need a scaredy cat to counteract this scary cat.
I really felt bad for the actress because she had to do some really just ridiculously goofy cowering and squealing. And
she goes to a lot of those Bond events, like screenings and stuff. She's one of the Bond girls that goes to a lot of those, and she just seems wonderful. She seems very appreciative.
Yeah, I wish that she had been served better by this
had a better
story,
role.
You know? Yeah. It's
had
a shame.
Writing.
She does as good a job as you're going to do with what she's asked to do, you know, but it was really jarring to me.
Yeah.
Because I don't remember her being quite that. I remember her being scared at all the voodoo stuff, which really holds up, I think. As cartoonish as the rest of her character is, the idea that the power of these symbols meaning something to her, I thought was very cool. Like, like the idea that if you understand this culture, you know that this is a bad thing to be seeing right now. That stuff worked for me, but it's weird. I forgot that the...
Let's talk about Roger Moore's explaining away the tiny hat and how wonderful that line was.
What is it?
I think it's something to the effect of a small man lost a fight with a chicken.
He goes on to use her fear to sleep with her.
That's what he does.
I know, but...
He is fantastic at analyzing a situation
and exposing a weakness,
what it is that will let him slide it in. Mm. Yep.
But in both instances in this movie where he deceives women into having sex, it's way too much trouble when he's on the job. It's like, you shouldn't be making this big plan to do this.
He does. Like, his whole hang gliding to sleep with solitaire.
Well, because he's about to go out and do something, and she goes, one more time. Like,
yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. All right. So
this'll keep.
This is we see Whisper again. Whisper is the wonderful
champagne. Anybody home?
Mr. and Mrs. Bond. Oh, by the way, I feel like his reaction to Mrs. Bond is interesting.
Yeah.
Because his wife did just die.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Like, but also as a secret agent, he kind of gives himself up a little bit there to that guy, to the concierge.
I thought that too.
Yeah.
I think that James Bond is the worst at being undercover.
He doesn't give a shit.
No, he doesn't.
Yeah. He doesn't care.
But always says his real name.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah.
He's like...
Celebrity spy.
Says it in a weird way that's repeating it so that you'll...
Yeah.
Making sure that you heard it.
Recognize it? James Bond. That's why he's doing it. Bond. James Bond. Maybe you've heard of him.
I'm a secret agent.
Wink, wink.
They had a line
Did you
of,
just say wink?
I'm working undercover for Her Majesty.
They had a line of tarot cards made after me.
Oh.
007.
Can't wait to get to those tarot cards.
Okay, so...
He takes a bath, which I kind of like.
Right.
Which,
yeah.
What?
I'm a bath guy.
He's just ready to read,
baths.
Have a good time, relax.
He's got a gold-plated shaving caddy.
Oh,
in there.
But guys, let's get into baths for one second.
All right.
Yeah.
Are they relaxing for more than 2 minutes?
Yes.
Oh.
Not to me. I can't do it.
I'm a bath guy.
I have a bath in my upstairs that I have never turned on.
I don't understand how when you get up early in the morning, you are faced with the option. Don't get me wrong. You shower off, you get clean first. But bath-wise, you have the option of stand up or continue your restful journey into day in a warm,
takes a bath to
womb-like
start the day?
Temperatures.
Who does that? No one takes a bath to start the day.
You're sitting at the table with one of them.
I call bullshit.
No.
You're not taking baths to start the day.
Yes, I do.
Why would you
take... Oh, I believe him.
Why wouldn't you?
It takes way more time.
That's okay. Not takes more time. You get more time.
Here's the thing. Here's what he does, Matt Myra.
Yes, Paul, thank you.
Matt Corley, and Matt, correct me if I'm wrong at any step of this.
You're probably right.
Gets out of bed, let's say, as late as possible.
Yeah.
goes to the bathroom,
yep.
turns on the tub,
uh-huh.
like, you know, make sure the water is at the right temperature as it's running, goes back into the bed.
No.
Because he's timed how long it takes the tub to fill up.
No. See, now you're just making a mockery of it.
What do you do? You lie down on the bathroom floor?
What do you do?
No. You get in, you take a quick shower, you get real clean.
And then
what?
Wait, so could you're not sitting in dirty bath water?
Yeah.
Okay, I support that part of it. Yes.
Right. Then,
wait, so you take a shower first and then you take a bath?
A quick shower to get the work done and then you reap the benefits.
If you are ever late for anything again.
Are you assuming
I've even showered today.
Are you stopping
Brilliant?
The tub? While you're taking the shower, so that the water
is... Well, no, not at first, because you want the dirty water to
okay,
go away.
Okay.
Oh, this is a whole other scenario in my head. I'm thinking you have a separate shower.
No, it's all one.
So you take a shower in the tub.
Yeah.
You're clean now. Mm-hmm. So you let the water drain out from the shower.
Sure.
Then you stop the tub.
Yeah.
And then you start the bath water.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you ever leave the tub?
No.
Okay. All right. So there's a period where you're cold and wet, waiting for this tub to fill.
But that's the best part, because you're like, comfort is coming.
Hold on a second. That's not the best part of anything.
Comfort is coming.
To be naked and cold is not the
Who
best part
Who said I was
of
naked? I'm wearing a terry cloth powder blue skin suit. No, I'm telling you, you don't love like a half hour soak. You got a book.
Can a friend have another friend committed, or do you have to be married?
Why is this crazy? People,
First of all, you're wasting a half hour of your morning.
Wasting?
You're not going to get him with that.
Man. Wasting? I'm being rewarded.
You're not.
I've been given a gift.
Sleep for
Angels
a half hour.
Have come down and said, let me give you the warmest gift.
I almost
feel as if we've gotten off topic.
Yeah, we have.
Ow.
Let's go back to the fact
it's just a weird sense that
okay.
I have.
Right. There's a snake in them, our boots.
This is the snake.
This is the snake Paul was previously thinking of.
This dumb snake.
All right.
Which wastes more time than Matt Gourley and Roger Moore's James Bond put together in the bathroom.
Do you know how many brilliant ideas I've had just in there, just thinking? You know what I'm saying?
You mean when most people would have these ideas in the shower?
I bet they're all tub-related, though.
They are.
Hey, how about a tub that had a built-in porcelain pillow?
What if the grout was lighter?
How about a clubfoot bath? Clubfoot bathtub.
Not a clawfoot.
No, clubfoot bathtub.
It wears a special shoe.
It's slanted, and so you can lean and sort of rest to one side.
Oh, my God. What if you could sleep underwater?
Why would you slant something that holds water?
So you slant over. Look, I don't need these speak for themselves.
You slant over.
There's a little waterfall that cascades out one side and then reclaims itself into irrigation water for the yard.
Oh, like an infinity tub.
Yep.
An infinity tub, of course.
Yeah. Sure. And rather than having a window on your wall, you just have a mural.
Okay.
You don't have a window. All right.
Let's talk about snake.
The snake.
Yeah.
The poisonous snake that is released into the bathroom.
Yes.
Via a heating duct.
Uh-huh. Snake gets into the bathroom, just kind of checking it out, looking around. You're like, oh, this is nice.
I guess I got some work to do. So this is my mission. Let me orient myself.
Oh, I'll be working with you. Oh, against you. Oh, I see.
Yeah, you're not even positive it's a poisonous snake. It could just be a garter snake.
Yeah. It's just a tiny snake.
It's just a snake.
Yeah.
And James Bond lights a cigar. As one does. As one does when you're
Roger Moore
you're
specifically
ready to
wanted to make that his thing. He doesn't smoke cigarettes. He was a cigar guy, yeah.
All right.
I fun facted the air out of
we
that
all
one.
All except James Bond must smoke something.
Well, why can't he just not smoke? No.
No.
He rolls
Brosnan
his eyes.
Is the first
say,
one
what
to
if
know.
He chews tobacco?
But Brosnan smokes cigars.
He did, yeah.
Yeah.
But he wasn't regularly.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. I mean, there's some regularity to doing it 25% of the time by being once in the four movies. Anyway. So he then uses this cigar as a weapon.
Yeah.
Thanks to his aerosol can
of powder blue shaving cream.
No, it's
aftershave. Yeah.
Whatever
it's
it is.
Weird, Why would there be an aerosol aftershave?
I know.
Well, they exist, Paul. They exist. And they did. My father.
Aerosol aftershave,
remember,
really?
I remember my father having an aerosol old spot.
And you just spray it in your hand or you spray it on your face?
Aerosol. I think he would spray it on his hands and then do this. I can't imagine you'd want to spray anything aerosol in your face.
So weird. I remember as a kid, my dad had Old Spice, but he had the bottle, you know, the traditional bottle.
Yeah.
And I remember.
You dab out that one.
I remember being fascinated by it. It's like how I didn't know how that worked. Yeah, it doesn't pour out. Just gives you, and the idea that look, don't go past this amount.
This is what
it gives you.
Those weird little gray caps. That was just
I vividly remember my father's high karate.
What? What's that?
You never heard of high karate?
High karate was an aftershave for men to catch on the karate shave.
Look up on YouTube. Look up the commercials for high karate.
Really?
Amazing.
Oh
my
god.
The high it was my dad's quintessential 70s aftershave. Yeah. High karate.
Wow.
But so he has an aerosol can of that, and he uses that and turns it into a flamethrower, which is something I think we've all done.
He super flinches when he first turns around.
Yeah.
When he first turns around to do it.
Yep.
Can I just briefly
say
he's not
quite looking in the right place. Like, the eye line is off, and he's like, dude.
He's like, are you sure this is safe?
He is a pacifist, Roger Moore. I don't think he was ever comfortable with that stuff. When I was younger, I experimented a lot with
the killing of poisonous snakes,
flamethrowers.
We all did.
And then one time,
I didn't actually.
You really didn't?
Yeah, I was a bit of a Roger Moore about it.
One time,
I think I saw somebody do it, and it really freaked me out. Like the wild kid that lived next door.
Is a Roger Moore about town?
I took a stick of deodorant and lit it, thinking, "Oh, this will be like a torch because they have alcohol in them as well."
Right.
And it sure did. And I was in my room, and I shook it to get it out, and the deodorant came out of the canister. Rolled under my bed on fire.
No.
I had my family's antique twin bed, and the box spring was just shredded with like material, and it just went. And I lit my bedroom on fire, and my buddy and I ran. We got pots full of water, and we put it out. But my carpet was all burned, and the bed was all burned, and I got in big trouble.
Gone so much worse.
Is this why you now spend so much time in the bathtub?
Yeah, well, I'm afraid of
fire.
You
want to be in water as long as possible.
Yeah, absolutely.
We solved it.
Wow.
Case closed.
Wow. The closest I came to lighting my house on fire
was lighting my house on fire.
Almost essentially. It was, again, I had a metal trash can, and... Remember the rolls of caps you could get as a child?
Oh, sure, yeah. I loved those.
I got as many of those as possible and lit them on fire.
Oh, my God.
And threw them in the
trash. But they don't pop when you light them on fire. They go...
Yeah, I found that out.
Yeah.
I threw that in the trash, not thinking that obviously the trash will then catch fire.
Oh, man.
And it was right next to our house, which was wood.
Yours is just slightly
and it
more
just
stupid
started, than mine. It just started going up the... And my next door neighbor happened to be the Lowell, Massachusetts fire marshal.
Oh, my God.
And he came over with the garden hose and put it out.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
It was,
that's kind of nice.
We've all almost burned our house down, right, Paul? You've burned your house down.
Have I? No, but you know what? I was accused of that when I was a little kid.
What?
We had a fire.
Were you wearing
house.
That tracksuit?
Because that might be why you were accused.
When I was a little kid, we had my parents were out. We had a babysitter, and there was a fire in our house. I remember the babysitter waking me up, you know, get out of the house, and
fire in your house?
Yeah. Okay. In the kitchen. And we went outside. We went next door to my cousin's house. They lived right next door, and fire department came and put out. It was a very small fire. But it was enough that it was like, we can't just throw a glass of water on this. We have to get out of here. And so I was interrogated by the fire captain.
Oh, wow.
And he said, "Were you playing with matches?" And I said, "No." And he said, "You're lying." And I was like, I was asleep, you know. And so I'm still on record as having started that fire. But what happened was my cousins were next door playing poker. And so the fire was set at our house, and then when everybody ran to deal with the fire, they stole the money off the table.
Who did?
Whoever set the fire. Like, they saw, because you could see into, it was ground level. You could
see
into
the fire. What an
elaborate
scheme.
Wait, but why didn't your babysitter vouch for you that she woke you up?
I'm sure she did.
I'm sure she started the fire.
I don't...
That you've never put
no,
that
she,
together?
She was a family friend. She
I'll
didn't
bet she was.
Well, it's always been burning since the world's been turning.
But But wait, she would have vouched for you, and they still were. You're still on record as the fire starter.
I don't know if they asked her. I mean, they might have said, "Is it possible that?"
Oh, have we just uncovered your criminal background?
This is the shittiest investigation.
I was wrongfully accused. It was. Jesus. It was terrible. It was terrible, and I will never forget that guy's face.
Oh my God,
you're lying, and like nobody stuck up for me. You know what I mean? Like, it was the weirdest. It was the weirdest thing. My mother told me years later, because I remembered it. My mother said, yeah, you're still on record as having, you know, that was the official story, was that kid was playing with matches and, you know.
Oh my goodness.
So the idea is, like, I was playing with matches. It got out of control. I was like, I better pretend to be asleep. Went upstairs. I'm like, I'll just let that fire go.
Upstairs. Yeah.
Obviously, this is going to be trouble. I better go pretend to be asleep.
Oh my God! I never knew.
That's horrible.
Oh my God,
that's an amazing story.
Wow.
Well, back to Roger Moore.
Yes. So the next morning, they go off. What's he wearing?
Oh my God! He's wearing a powder blue denim jumpsuit.
Well, denim jacket.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. You got a jumpsuit.
Low scoop neck wife beater,
which I didn't like. I could even handle the powder blue two piece denim.
You know why I didn't like it?
Ugh.
I feel like he doesn't have the upper body nor arms to wear
He's
that.
Smooth guy. He's a smooth guy. Smooth tan
he
guy.
He has one of those transitional bodies from when it's like he's clearly fit and he's in good shape, but there's no definition to his body at all. Yeah. You know, and it's not it's before it gave way to like that being super cut. Yeah. You know,
his whole upper body is like one firm calf. Shaven calf.
Yeah. You nailed it.
Yeah.
This is now at the point where Rosie is the
she's revealed herself as a terrible CIA agent,
terrible CIA
and
agent.
A double agent.
Well,
right?
This is
so confusing.
I know it's not very clear.
She's a terrible CIA agent and a terrible double agent. She's a terrible agent all around.
Yeah,
she's in the wrong business.
She is no agent. Let's not have a no agent. So they have to take a boat somewhere. So when you're in the world of James Bond and you want to take a boat somewhere, you got to hire Quarrel.
Mm-hmm.
Well, unfortunately.
We don't know yet.
Unfortunately.
Quarrel Jr., right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Quarrel has died and at some point gave way to his namesake. And,
who seems older than
who
him.
Who seems older.
How is that possible?
Absolutely correct.
Quarrel Jr., he was born in a time vortex.
Meet the man who shares my hairbrush. Okay, I understand that means you're close, but it seems weird.
Yeah, I don't...
What does that mean?
Expression? What does that expression
mean? It might be. It must be.
I wrote that down on paper while I was watching. I was like, what does this...
I'm going to start using it, though.
The man who's on toothbrush terms.
Meet the man who shares my hairbrush is going to be my new
intro
for people.
That's the way to do it, I guess. So, we don't know what's going on. He's fishing off the back of the boat with his tiny arm.
What's happening?
With his tiny
arm. Isn't there some sort of mission that he's supposed to be on? Why is he fishing? I remember being like, when he sits down and gets the rod and reel, I'm like, what? What are you doing?
I got time to kill.
How could we slow the plot down? Deep sea fishing.
So the boat captain seems like he's about
Boat captain seems like he might be a bad guy. He's got the rope.
So Rosie is sent downstairs to change.
Yeah.
Just into she's already wearing the bathing suit.
Me?
Right?
Like, change clothes. Where?
So she goes downstairs.
He's not deaf.
To hang up her robe on a hook and then
That already has something hanging on it. Why hasn't it pulled it down?
Well, it just wasn't quite heavy enough.
All right.
Needed the robe.
Yeah. So to reveal some sort of radio.
Radio.
Yeah.
Weird thing to have on a boat.
Oh, where there is high quality radio and a gun.
Something suspicious about this. Well, just the idea that it's hidden, I guess. Why is it? Anyway, so she goes up and she sees Quarrel Jr. holding a rope.
By the way, this is the most agent-like thing she does.
It is the only agent thing she does.
Yeah.
She thinks that James is in danger.
Yes.
And
she pulls her gun.
Keep up the facade. She decides.
Facade.
She decides to threaten him, to kill him.
Yeah.
But then, obviously, they share a hairbrush. Yeah. Now,
so even that, she's failed at.
Yeah. And why is she wearing a wig?
I had that same thing.
Why
is she wearing a wig?
There's no reason.
But wasn't that kind of the thing? That was kind of the style of the day?
It was just a fashion thing, not a variety.
Exactly. Yeah. It's, yeah. And because she would have looked cool either way, either with the big afro or with the short hair.
Yeah.
So, but it's just like a further thing to humiliate her.
Yeah, that's exactly what that is.
It's the only reason it exists.
That's exactly right. The now this is the, they go to the cove, right? And this is where we start to see these scarecrows.
Right, which are awesome looking.
Yeah.
They're great looking.
Really are.
Yeah. And then we find that the crows, the scarecrows, have lenses for eyes and guns for mouths.
Yeah. They keep the crows out.
This is when Roger Moore is the least believable in this scene, when he threatens to shoot her.
Oh, really?
Because I'm just like, Roger Moore, James Bond would never, I feel like he would never shoot her.
We will have to.
And the way he threatens it, too, is just not even like.
But
he's
this,
not even into it.
This anymore. Screaming Mimi doesn't know that.
Yeah.
Right?
True.
We'll She's scared of a coconut head.
She knows nothing.
With the one real downfall in these Roger Moore ones is how he kisses is really uncomfortable. And
I didn't know.
It's not so bad in
the
this.
The amount of time that you and I, adult men, have discussed the kissing styles of actors who've portrayed James Bond is concerning.
Well, I've had a lot of time in the bath to think about it. All right.
On the lookout for snakes.
There's something, like, it's almost like he's pushing away. You don't get the feeling he ever wants to kiss these women. With Connery, you feel like he's not even acting. He just wants to kiss
them. Too much.
You know? Yeah. Same with Lazenby. Like, they have to pull him off.
Get a hose.
Cut!
Anyway, all right.
Right.
Why do I have "make your choice" written down as a quote?
Oh,
what
wait till you find out why.
You don't know.
Oh, I know.
You do?
Yes, I
what
do.
What is that? Make your choice.
I know.
Oh, damn.
I don't remember either.
Make your choice.
Make your choice. Do you have it in quotes or is it?
Yeah.
Make your choice. Did that help?
As make Alec your choice. Guinness.
That was Rosie. All right. So Rosie unfortunately meets her maker at the hands of a scarecrow mouth. That has a gun in it. Remote control scarecrow.
She gets the real thick red paint blood.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
She gets the full.
I don't know if it is a holdover from watching it when I was a kid or if it still works. But her reaction to the voodoo stuff really packed a punch for me. It was the one thing that I liked about her character. Was that she made that real for me? But I don't know.
Okay, so
he's accusing her of
he's
doing
her.
An act, but she really is afraid of these things.
Yeah.
Well, I think she's just afraid of dying. And I can't tell if it's at the hands of the voodoo or if it's at the hands of Kananga.
I think she knows it's Kananga, right? The one good thing that this movie does is it rides this border of are things supernatural or are they just happening out of fear from the things until the end?
Yes.
Of course.
Well, there's something coming up very soon that.
Well, let's now discuss.
Oh yeah,
we have to discuss. James now must go see solitaire.
Of course he must,
because why not? And he does so by hang gliding in what appears to be a black pea coat and a black suit. That's what I'm thinking it is the whole time. He then some sort of Morse code. Let's Quarrel know that he's gonna release. And fly
so,
into...
Like, for him to take care of the hairbrush until he gets back.
Yeah, it's just the hairbrush is on you. The hairbrush is on you. James then flies in. When he releases the hang glider, he then rips away his black pants to reveal a tan pant. And then you're like, well, that's not going to match that jacket. Oh, don't worry. Inside out.
Oh, jeez.
Why?
I guess to look like he's not intruding or...
Just in case, and it really came in handy.
I suppose. Do you think that he just was like, "What outfit am I the most attractive in?" Like, was that sort of his aim? Like, he's like, "I gotta land here," because it seems like James Bond's intent here is to just go there and have sex with Solitaire.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to find out what's going on with Mr. Big and all that stuff. He doesn't
Why
know about
would
the
he
heroin
bring
yet.
A stack of lover cards.
Oh, well, that's for sure. I think he's going in for that reason to get information from her, but he doesn't know what he's going to find or what he's going to need to know. He's going in prepared. I'm not defending.
He doesn't
this.
Know what he's going to find or what he needs to know, but he knows he must sleep with her.
Yeah.
Okay, we agree
well,
on
I
that.
Well, I think he knows that she's going to be the most sympathetic or easy way into this organization.
You can try, man.
I'm not trying to defend it.
This is a whole section of this film that the movie just stops making sense for a while.
Yeah, yeah.
Which
most Bond films have.
Why does he change the outfit? Why would he go and print up a fake deck of tarot cards?
I imagine he bought something of 50 or so different decks.
You think he bought like 50 decks?
Because he goes at the hotel, he goes, I just need to go get some tarot cards.
Yeah, and that's when he goes into the tarot
cards.
He
couldn't have had them printed.
So he bought 50 identical
decks. And they have those on...
And why wouldn't she just use her own cards?
Yeah.
It's her whole thing.
Yeah.
This is her whole thing.
You can imagine she'd have like the finest of the fine. You know?
And would probably be like, no,
yeah.
I have a gift to see the future,
yeah.
So I'll use my card.
I'll just use this.
And why do these say 007 on the back? But even hers do.
Yes, no.
They're the same set.
Yeah, they're the same set. But also, I'm torn here because I guess he's sleeping with her. Is he sleeping with her just to sort of like tear down the whole sort of whatever infrastructure they have with her as the psychic person and Kananga as the one who needs to know all the information?
Because
is that what he's doing?
He knows that she's very important to Kananga, right?
Yeah.
So, and he knows that her being, she's a virgin, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And that is important, her being intact is important to this perceived psychic gift or whatever. So then it turns out she seemingly does have an actual psychic gift, and so her being deflowered destroys that, and now she can't see the future anymore, to which she adjusts remarkably quickly.
Yeah.
Like, and imagine if you had the power to see the fucking future, and then all of a sudden, you have sex, and then it's gone, and then she's like, my gift is gone, and then, like, 2 minutes later... He's like, do you want to go again? She's like, yeah.
Well, what's worse is he even admits, he says, I have to admit the deck was a little stacked. Oh, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Yeah. No.
I had a supernatural power.
And you took it.
But I mean,
tricked me.
There is some justification in her mind that like the initial, I mean, he did pull the lover card.
Yeah.
Off of her deck originally when they first encountered each other in Phileo Sol.
Okay.
Which is not... Is it a fish? It's a fish, right? That's what they're saying?
Yeah, but it's also soul food. Yeah. I think it's soul seafood.
Catfish. New Orleans style
there
catfish.
There you go. Okay. Done. Figured it out.
Only serve catfish.
Yeah.
It's a catfish restaurant.
She's okay with it because she's aware that like her mother lost the ability and her mother before her lost the ability, right? Is that what's happening?
Yeah.
But do they all work for... Did they all always work for the Kanangas?
I don't know.
I want someone to find out. Okay. So now they need to run through a field of heroin to escape.
Yeah.
From
just
a helicopter.
Like in The Wizard of Oz.
From a helicopter. Everyone remembers. In fact, in this movie, if you pause it, you can see someone hanging from a heroin plant.
Watch this movie backwards to Pink Floyd's.
Actually, you watch
bath
this.
Time.
This one, you play The Wall. Yeah, it's not Dark Side of the Moon. So, yeah, they run... Oh, this is the double-decker bus chase.
Yeah, which is pretty amazing.
Which, now, watching the...
doing a 360.
Doing a 360. Watching the behind-the-scenes.
Yes, I have something to say about this, too.
They actually let... They had Jane Seymour in this bus.
I feel
while they were filming this crazy 360.
She makes it sound like they're like... Oh, it's not the bridge. She's talking about the 360.
Yeah.
Because I thought I remember where she's like, I was in the bridge and they didn't even tell me they were going to bust the roof off or something. I guess it was the 360.
No, she was in, and they have all this footage of her. They have all this footage of them attempting this 360 thing, and she's in it. And like, you just see her in there, and you're like, you cannot make out who that is. There's no reason for you to put your lead actress in this bus.
Yeah.
And they just did. And they just did.
Yeah.
And then they didn't even score. By the way, they didn't even score the bus.
For the
roof to come
off.
They just drove it like that. Jeez. They just drove it through there.
Why?
The 70s?
Yeah.
Oh.
That's what it
is. Insane.
It's bonkers. And
it's a miracle anyone's alive.
It really is. I don't know how I'm here. I assume my karate was poison. The double decker bus. The bus comes. The top half of the bus comes off. Falls on a car,
mm-hmm.
as you'd think it would. Mm-hmm. And the car, for some reason, then loses all ability to stop.
Absolutely.
And drives nicely into the water, where a bunch of children come out very excited. then this is a scene I have forgotten about every time I've seen this movie. I forgot about it, and now I will try and remember it forever. But the plane chase
with the old lady in the World War One flying helmet
and the Phil Silvers glass.
Yeah.
Brent
Summers.
Oh my goodness. Really.
It is a weird thing to put so in right silly. Before a boat and a car chase.
Like, at no
they,
point.
They do planes,
it's a weird
and
Smokey and the Bandit moment, too. Yeah. And she's like, holy shit.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
First time with the S word, I think, in a Bond movie.
Yeah.
It does feel out of place when she says
this,
it.
Yeah. Whole, yeah.
There's this whole sequence, this whole New Orleans, Louisiana sequence of the plane chase and the boat chase. They just seem so, bless me, they just seem so
obligatory.
I don't know. They just don't seem necessary.
Yeah.
Not that,
do you know what, though? I really liked the boat chase.
I did, too.
For a while.
It goes on too long.
It goes on too long.
Because it almost has two stages, right? Where he
Yeah, that's a big problem.
Before and after the wedding.
Those James Bond movies.
Yeah.
With the cool priest and the sunglasses.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Watching Guy Hamilton direct that scene. There's a scene. There's a footage of him directing that scene in the documentary. And the way he's talking to the crowd, he's just like, "Now there's going to be a boat that's going to come through here."
Yeah, it's so general.
He's like, "It's going to come through here. There's going to be another one that comes around in the water. Look at whichever one you want."
Pick a boat.
He's like, doesn't matter which.
Pretend you're a person seeing two boats. And then do what a person would do, looking at either one boat or the other. You may look from one boat to the other and back again.
Either way, stay safe.
Best of luck, chap. Right.
I'll be over here.
I'll be in my director's bunker.
It just screams of how he directed those movies.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, it's just like,
no doubt.
Whatever. We're all here. I'm going to see jazz later.
On whose side?
This guy is the worst.
J.W. Pepper.
And I'm assuming he's dead.
Well, he's in those documentaries looking
I bet
the
he is
same.
Now. Let me look him up.
On whose side?
This is the most.
It's so tortured, everything he says.
This is the most
and
uncomfortable
it's all ADR
I've ever been.
Too.
I hereby commandeer this vehicle, including the two people inside of it, which means you and also to the right of you, that fellow right there making a duel.
Oh my God. And so there's a discomfort I felt in watching him try to arrest the black guy in the chase.
And he calls him boy,
right? Boy. Absolutely.
It's so uncomfortable.
Absolutely.
Just to put 10 fingers on the hood, boy.
Yeah.
Now, why do I feel like this isn't the first time? Yeah.
It's almost like the movie is saying, hey, you thought we were racist, but this is what is really racist. Don't forget, the South.
Still alive, Clifton James.
Oh, we should get
Clifton,
him in here.
Clifton,
1921.
I'm sure you've been better in other things.
In Superman 2, where you played the same character.
Yeah, not your strong suit, despite evidence to the contrary.
Bonanza, the Virginian.
He only did Southern stuff?
Basically.
The Virginian. Wow.
Why? He's terrible. He's terrible.
What are you, boy?
I have a soft
spot. The apocalypse.
I have a soft spot for him. I don't know what it is. I don't know.
Well, probably because you were a child and didn't understand how horrible it was.
Are you making perhaps a misguided favorable comparison to Jackie Gleason?
Buford T. Justice.
And the Bandit?
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Who was much better.
Oh, yeah.
He's brilliant.
Exceedingly so. Lord. Okay, so boat chase goes on far too long, which is, I think, a problem of a lot of those James Bond movies of the era.
And movies today.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think there's a lot of action sequences that are like, I understand
how much money
you're trying
you're
to give me. Yeah, you're. That's like only in the movies can you see this sort of action. But it's like this should be over by now.
Yeah. Which is why I really love watching. Are you just drawing Ian Fleming? What are you doing?
Just doodling.
What was I saying about movies? Oh, actually, the James Bond movies, especially the early ones. We talked about this a bit on the Dr. No episode, but they're just sort of like these wonderful let's go to a travelogue situation of like let's really look at this place. And that's fine, and it's wonderful that it's there, and if you're really in the mood you can watch it, but being on Blu-ray and being able to fast forward through some of this stuff is the greatest thing that's ever happened to me.
Did you fast forward while you were watching?
I did
a little bit through the boat chase.
Oh, really?
I did not.
I felt like it was a little excessive. I was like,
if anything, I slowed it down.
That's your best friend. If you watch Thunderball, though, that's your best friend.
Yeah.
Fast forwarding through Thunderball. Mm-hmm. Oh, that movie. So at this point, James is in the boat. The boat chase happens, but then he gets captured again.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. When did Kananga confront Solitaire when he realizes she's been despoiled? Is that about to happen or has that happened already? I'm looking at the timeline of my notes. Because there's one line of dialogue.
Did they catch them in the poppy?
Oh, that happens right there.
Okay.
It happens here.
Great, okay.
Yes, it happens right here because once they get split up, she gets captured and that's when the questioning is happening.
Right.
Because she gets questioned and then separately they both get questioned in a separate scene. So, yes, here we are.
He's got
to know.
James Bond's watch.
He's got James Bond's watch.
Oh, this is at the alligator farm.
What's the registration number?
Yes.
Registration number.
Yeah.
What's the registration number on the watch? And she bluffs it.
Yep.
She gets it wrong.
Yep.
And then he says the craziest line of dialogue I've ever heard. I gave you a 50-50 chance, and you weren't even close.
It's set true. Me up it's to true. Fail if it's that true. Was your criteria.
It's true.
I can only be.
It's true.
Well, yeah. If I got the one wrong thing,
you were
then
not,
I guess
you were not.
I was.
Even
I was
close.
Both extremely close and not close at all.
I love Butterhook.
Butterhook is still a great line.
Yeah.
I mean it's a flat out joke.
Yeah.
That is a flat out joke.
Yeah. Yeah.
Butterhook.
Yeah. So how does he get out of this one? They take him out to They take him out to the alligators.
To the gators, yeah.
Now,
if you
do have a chance to watch the Inside Live and Let Die documentary,
please do.
It's amazing because
which one is Teehee? I'm sorry.
He's the hook hand. Butterhook.
Why is he called Teehee?
I don't know. That's just what he's called.
That's what he's called in the novel.
Oh, I just assumed he had some hooky name that
I
missed.
Yeah.
Teehee.
Yeah.
Well, also the hook is not in the novel. They all have these whimsical names.
Yeah, I don't know if it
is. No, the hook is not in the novel.
I can't remember.
I'm sorry, but please. But pray continue.
So this guy, Ross Kananga, owns this alligator farm, and he does the stunt where Bond jumps across those alligators, but they show the four takes before that
he fails and falls in, and it's amazing.
Yeah, it's really worth watching.
But he's not...
He does not jump over these alligators. He fucking steps on alligators.
Yeah, they're tied down, but only in the middle so they can...
They're real alligators?
Yes. That's a real stunt.
Yes.
And there's,
oh, my God.
There's four or five alternate
takes... I love it even more now.
...where he falls in, and you see him falling in and just scurry
to
get
Jesus.
Away. Oh, yeah.
Jesus.
There's one, there's one where a gator gets his pant leg.
Yeah.
And, like, the gator tooth is, like, stuck on the billowy bell-bottom pant.
I can bring that.
Billowy bell-bottom.
You got billowy bell-bottoms.
That sequence is great.
Yep.
Alligators, crocodiles are terrifying.
Yes.
And that the whole, like the one creeping up on him on that little stone island and him throwing the chicken and all that, it's so good. It's absolutely terrific today.
We're now going to watch this thing that doesn't have too much sound.
Oh, shit.
Oh, these are the takes where he blows it?
Yeah. There's no sound, but we're showing Paul.
Oh no! I don't even like seeing that.
Wait for his leg to get caught.
It gives me the willies.
He's just
Oh, that gator's going crazy, God, too. Like, I want to get at it.
They all remind me of my cat.
Need to get out of the tub. That's the
no!
one.
No!
Yeah, YouTube it. If,
yeah, his pant leg. Look at.
If you guys have a computer or an iPad or an iPhone or a tablet device, check it out on
if
YouTube.
If you have a Samsung Galaxy, yeah. If you have
a Starbucks Orange Valencia refresher, check it out.
That's the drink of choice for the man who likes baths. The man who likes baths in your life.
Well, you give me a bath, a Starbucks Orange Valencia refresher.
What's an Orange Valencia refresher?
I thought
it like
was
a
made
milkshake?
Up. I thought he was pulling my leg when I asked him, what do you want from Starbucks? I'm going to run over to Starbucks. And he said, an orange refresher Valencia. And I was like,
that's wrong
very
order.
Funny.
It does sound like a thing you would make up, to be fair.
It's very funny.
Maybe I did.
Very funny, Matt Gourley.
Maybe I did.
You willed it into being, like
I
Billy
wish,
Mumy in that Twilight Zone.
Okay, so the Gator Farm is before the boat chase, by the way. We flipped that
is
in
it?
Our because that's where he steals the boat.
Okay. We all did it.
Yeah.
That's right. He sets a fire.
Yep.
He
fire again.
Okay, so he leads the gators like a trail of chicken
death.
Parts
yeah. to their death
to go into the thing and then
the
sets it on fire.
Yeah, that's correct.
Well, why?
That's correct. That's correct.
Why
to scare the people? Yeah, he's gonna kill the. I don't know.
It's I like one or the other. You know what I mean? Like, but he so he wants to burn down the lab, right?
Yeah. Yes.
But does he not want to kill the people? This is James Bond being magnanimous.
Maybe. Maybe.
Just... No reason you should die.
They're just heroin refiners. They shouldn't.
Yeah.
No harm should come to them.
Fair's fair. You gave me a chance to escape from the alligators.
Okay, so now... at this point... Okay.
Then he heads to Jamaica, right?
He heads to Jamaica
and so
to get to save... Solitaire.
Yes, but he's also going to take down Kananga.
To take down Kananga and save Solitaire. Okay, now let's talk about this now.
Okay, let's get into
this. This is the part that as a child I was always so confused by, and it turns out as an adult,
yeah,
I'm still confused by it. The what's his face? The guy that is not Teehee,
whose Whisper? Name I keep
not Whisper.
Baron Samedi.
Oh, Baron Samedi.
Yes, yeah. Baron Samedi. Okay,
who's based on is a real voodoo figure, Baron yeah. Samedi. Yeah,
and a great GoldenEye character.
Very true.
In the video.
Very game. True. Oh. You should really get on that game.
Yeah.
Man, little sidebar. Yeah. Do not lose your place. Remember what we're talking about. The last episode, you guys talking about the GoldenEye video game, I wanted to play it so badly. I wanted to play it so badly. And if I may I indulge in a quick story?
Yes, please, please.
When we were working on Mr. Show way back when, that game had just come out. And we were in this new we had this new green room set up from when we were recording the episodes where we had this bungalow on the lot. And we brought in GoldenEye because there was this big screen TV in there.
Wow.
And so while we were waiting to be called to set, we would play the game. And everybody was playing it. Everybody was playing it. And the season was split into two halves. And so the first half, we had our regular crew. And the second half, we had different people who were the stage managers and everything.
Uh-huh.
So these new people who didn't know us would come to the bungalow to call us to set. And we were like kids. We're like, yeah, I'm coming. And we were playing this game. They hated us. They hated us. And I felt so bad. Like, no, if you knew us, you well, like, of course we'll be there on time because we know that we'll get there and then we'll just end up waiting around. We're playing this game and like, we'll be fine because we've been doing this for years. They hated us.
Oh,
we could not
God.
Stop playing that game.
Who was the best?
Oh, me.
Yeah. Nice.
Really?
I would say me and Jay Johnston were probably the best.
We should have a thing because I've only played it once. We should play it because I also
I
got
would
this.
Love to
I have it.
Game again.
I got this.
Do you
thing.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's
do it.
Yeah.
Do you have what Xbox or PlayStation?
Well, I have an N64.
They made a bad version apparently for another.
They made, yeah, they made the
Daniel
new
Craig
GoldenEye
version.
Revisited.
Yeah,
but which I'm just saying.
I wanted it so bad, and then I read the reviews, and everybody hated it.
They just hate it. Here's why they hate it.
Yes,
they just hate it because. They just hate it because it's not quite what they remember, and the nostalgia factor
it's
I think
the same
makes
engine,
them hate
right?
it. It really is the same sort of gaming map,
right.
beautifully updated. And I honestly, I find it enjoyable.
We should do both.
I find it enjoyable. We can
Let's do
both.
Side by side comparison.
I know.
Blind taste test.
We'll do it at your place, but if you want, we could do it at my place because I got this remote. One button will turn on my game system. My
go take
my
a bath.
Home theater and start running a bath. One button.
Oh my God.
One button.
I mean, sure.
All right.
Oh, and also, the last time I played that game, I think was on mushrooms at a Halloween party. It was me and my friend.
A lot of layers of bad ideas.
Oh, it started out great. It was so, we were playing, well, it was multiplayer games, me and my friend Ken Daly.
Oh, I know Ken, yeah, sure.
One other person and Bill Odenkirk were all playing at this party. And me and Ken are on mushrooms, and maybe the third person was on mushrooms. I can't remember who it was. And Bill Odenkirk.
Of course, the third person was just hallucinated, wasn't even there.
No, possibly. Okay. No, I remember four screen. But we're playing, and it's so it's multiplayer, and we're playing against each other. And, you know, sometimes the music would get really speedy and silly.
Yes.
And Ken and I started laughing. Like, we thought it all of a sudden, at the same time, it became the most hilarious thing. And we were dying laughing playing this game. And then Bill Odenkirk says, "I don't see what's so funny." And then immediate bad trip.
It all
turned inside out, like, why are we playing this? This is horrible. Oh. I don't want to shoot anybody.
And you got old.
Yeah, I got old. I aged like 50 years.
So after we recorded that GoldenEye podcast, Craig, who's been staying with me because he lives in New York, but he's out here writing on At Midnight, he was like, "Oh, do you have the GoldenEye thing? I'd like to play it." And I was like, "Yeah, yeah." And I fired up the Xbox version, the new updated version, and I went to go do something in the kitchen, and I just hear him terrified. Like, he's the kind of guy who plays video games and gets so scared.
He takes it on.
He just goes, "Oh no, die, come on." Oh,
I get that
the whole time. It is the funniest thing.
I get that way a little bit.
I just want to, like, record him unknowingly while he's playing the game. It's so funny. Oh, he gets genuinely terrified. He says that.
No.
He says the words, "Oh no.
Why?
The humanity.
What kind of god?
Tense. You bought me that infinite shock.
BioShock Infinite.
And I love it, but when you're on that skyhook thing, I get that same feeling I get when I'm on top of a building. You know, the height.
I almost
thing.
Get that too. The skyhook. The timing of it, I'm not good at. It always makes me nervous.
That game, I still have it unopened. I have not played
it's
it.
It's so much fun, yeah. Matt.
We'll play that too.
Yeah. Video game day.
Yeah.
Let's really make this happen.
We'll run a path.
I want to play that goal.
We'll run a path and we'll do it.
All right.
Hey, we'll get those Cialis tubs. Okay. We'll all be in our own bathtub.
I would absolutely do that. Those copper football bathtubs.
You're the only person who looks at that commercial and says, "This is a great idea."
What's the problem?
It makes sense to me.
Yeah.
You're the only person to whom that commercial makes sense.
Guys, I'm not going to lie, but the three of us in separate bathtubs outside with, like, a projected screen of GoldenEye, that can't be a bad idea.
No. Couple of.
It's only impossible.
You got a Starbucks orange Valencia refresher
all
by
right,
your side.
You went too far.
You're doing well.
You went too far.
All right. So he goes to the island.
Yep.
He's wearing all black turtleneck. He's looking not like Bond, but pretty awesome.
Looks pretty cool.
He's got a 44 Magnum, which has to be copying the Dirty Harry craze.
But by the way, this look, there's a couple of times in Archer where they put this exact outfit on him and the exact gun, and it just cracks me up.
I love the look.
It's a great look. Yeah, it's a great secret agent spy look.
Yeah.
Now back to what terrified me as a child. I was so confused by the concept of this real-looking human being getting blown apart.
Yeah.
And turning to porcelain.
By a magnum.
Yeah. Totally forgot that.
But the eyes move.
The eyes move. And it just scared the shit out of me.
It is a hell of an effect because the eyes look real.
Yeah. The one thing that's disappointing about this whole sequence is that now seeing it as an adult, it's so clearly a set.
When
I was a kid, it was very like, where are they?
Yeah.
You know, but now you look at it, it's like this might well be like Gilligan's Island.
It might have been. By the way, okay, so
cab.
What'd you say?
Where's the bamboo petty cab? You know that catchphrase.
Yes.
And the bicycle powered laundry.
Where's
just put that in our list of well-known catchphrases, along with "Share's a hairbrush."
That's right.
So,
"Share's a hairbrush."
This is the casket of snakes that we see again.
Yes,
it's a coffin of snakes. It's not
What's
a
the
casket.
Difference between a
the
ca-
shape, right?
Coffin and a casket.
Yeah, a coffin is the contoured. Coffin is the one that's angular.
Yes.
And then a casket is the square thing we're used to. Yeah, it's a little funeral home knowledge for you.
Oh. Thank then you.
Which one's a Thank meteorite?
That is what's coming in the
No,
atmosphere.
No, that's what is on the ground.
It's Vegemites grow from the top.
Okay. Stalactites better hang on tighter, though. Fall
that's
off.
A...
Stalagmite might reach the ceiling if it grows.
You're thinking
enough.
Of Nutella.
I see.
Okay. So
latex an object.
The coffin full of snakes is there. You'd think the way this gentleman has been built up, you know, everyone's yeah. sort of terrified of him. He seems to have some sort of mystical abilities. Mm-hmm. He has porcelain copies of
they
himself.
They say he never dies.
Never
he
dies.
Cannot die.
Can't die.
They say he never dies. That guy in the little, like, what reminded me of what they used to have at the Disneyland Hotel. Have you ever been?
No,
in the
that
70s?
Was that was a scene from the Polynesian Resort. Like, it might as well have been just welcome to our luau.
I love that guy, Baron Samedi. I love
Now,
that
of
guy.
Course, for our purposes, he's just here to dance.
Yes.
But so you'd think this to me, this was the fight that I was anticipating.
Yeah.
As a kid, even I was like, this is gonna be a crazy great fight. And it's not.
You get this is unique because you get the villain dead and you still have two henchmen alive at the end.
Yeah.
One to fight, which isn't uncommon, but then another one at the front of the train.
What does that tell you? What are we supposed to take away from that?
I think it's just they wanted to do what they wanted to do. I don't think there's anything special about
it. I really didn't like that.
I didn't like it either.
I didn't like it. Yeah, the fight with him is over way too quickly.
Yep.
But the thing at the end with Baron Samedi on the front of the train is just like it's a great cut into the skull, into the flaming skull again.
Yeah.
But it's just like,
what are you telling us with that button? What are you trying
to
convey?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's too far.
Yeah,
it's too far.
It's one step too far.
He's hanging out in the front of this. And it's also the train. It's like a locomotive, like from, Butch Cassidy or something.
Also, is he stowing away or did he have a ticket?
That's a good question. Yeah. He could have been in the bag next to Teehee.
Yeah. We're a little bit far ahead of ourselves.
We're about to visit one of, I think, all three of our favorite moments in the history of James Bond.
So crazy. The worst James Bond death in history? Is that what we're talking about?
No, I would say it's the best.
I think it's the worst and the best.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. But before we get to that,
that's why we had you on.
Yaphet Kotto's knife fighting style is amazing. Where he keeps doing these dance moves, but he looks.
Yeah, but that makes him somehow seem more terrifying with a
knife.
Yeah,
I love it.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. I love it.
Yeah,
I think
it's terrific.
Amazing.
Like, he's great. Yaphet Kotto's great.
Yeah, he is.
He's great.
He's very good. He's very good in this. And also, so this is, again, another instance of us seeing a James Bond gadget that was never explained to us by Q.
No. Or, I mean, really, up until that point, hasn't really been that well described.
It's a gun.
Deus Ex Machina.
It's a gun that shoots a canister of compressed gas. We'll say 1 cubic inch.
Why not?
Yeah, sure.
Whoa,
we'll say 1 cubic
that's
inch.
That's right.
Of
I
haven't
even thought about that. How much could come out of that little thing?
So,
what? And why is that how you kill sharks? Why not just an explosive bullet? Why? What's unique about sharks that you need to blow them up like a balloon?
I don't know.
I guess if you shoot them with a bullet, it's not fast enough. With a bullet, they'll still
I can still chomp down on you.
Because
I mean, Quint stabbed
him
a lot.
That's true,
and he still
that's true. That shark was shot several times.
Yes, many times.
Mm. Yeah,
and he went under with 3 barrels.
Not with 3.
We should do a Jaws podcast.
It's already been taken care of.
So the this gas canister. He explains what it does. And Kananga, in his infinite wisdom, decides, I'm going to try this out. So he...
I got to see what this will be.
He shoots it towards Whisper. Whisper thinks, oh my God, is this guy going to kill me? Which I liked because Whisper going like, oh, this guy's going to shoot me, makes me think that Kananga is even more crazy, terrifying bad guy than we previously thought.
Yeah.
That he would just kill his own henchman. But he shoots it at the leather couch. And then... The leather couch.
Couch blows up like a bouncy house.
Just like a bouncy house.
It pushes Whisper to the ground, launches him into the air.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Like that this leather couch then just turns into a balloon.
Was that elastic?
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Love it.
So at this point, we're like, these things are pretty dangerous. Yeah, if it can do that to a leather couch, what could it?
I'm drawing a conclusion. If it could do that to a leather couch, you would not want to get shot with it.
Not at all.
No. I don't see where you guys are going. Are you
what I'm saying is, Matt, you do well to get shot with anything else.
Yeah. Oh. I mean, Whisper himself was so close to being shot by this thing. Uh-huh. By the grace of Kananga. The couch was shot instead. Can you imagine?
Yeah, but the odds
bullet
of someone
pierced
getting,
his flesh?
Well, how's anybody? No, the odds of someone getting shot by that.
Are... You're probably right. Okay. You're well, I pray that
on.
You are.
Okay, let's go.
I have
on.
To imagine, by the way, they made 2 Kananga balloons and only used one of them. So somewhere out there is an uninflated Kananga.
I don't think
Kananga.
They did because...
It's every Thanksgiving.
Oh, God. Wouldn't that be great, the Macy's Thanksgiving Day break?
As the very last float.
The kid,
the Kananga balloon.
The
but
kid
it's
from,
only the size of that.
Yes.
No, the kid
it's
from
the
Charlie
size.
And the Chocolate Factory.
Yes!
And then Kananga. And
she
else?
Didn't float, though. She was dense.
But still.
She turned into a blueberry, and she still had normal-sized hands.
Someone else blows up in something, too. I don't know.
I'm sure.
Stands to reason.
Oh, God.
So James is tied up along with Solitaire. They're tied up over a tank full of sharks.
Kananga cuts him.
James,
in case the sharks don't get the idea.
Right? Yeah. They don't know it's feeding time. He's going to let them know. This is when now the watch gadget tree just goes full bananas.
Yeah.
Yeah, magnetic watch.
Yeah, the magnetic watch blade. That is also a circular saw.
And tells time.
Mm-hmm. I forgot that it was also a saw.
He's basically R2-D2 at this point.
He really is. Whatever he needs, at some point he will shoot a lightsaber out of it.
Y'all imitating R2-D2s. Y'all imitating R2-D2s.
What was that from originally?
Sketchfest.
Yeah, but...
We were backstage.
But I thought when you did it the first time, like, oh, that's got to be from something.
No, it was just you guys were doing
like
that.
Sounds like the thing.
Right. You guys were doing that, I thought that's a character that would be delighted by it.
Can I come in? You guys doing R2-D2?
Hey, y'all imitating R2-D2s?
I heard from out there you were. All right.
Okay. All right, so you're like, how are they going to get out of this? How are they going to get out of this situation? Yeah. Well, we've already established that this watch is a very powerful magnet.
Yeah, it takes off women's clothing.
And it takes apparently the only metal object in this room full of metal objects.
Right.
in an entirely stainless steel compound.
Yeah. It is powerful.
Certainly
enough.
Not the knife that Kananga is about to use that would come streaming at him.
No.
Cut
not
off
even
his
a little.
Hand at the
he takes the. He takes the most dangerous projectile known to man, shoots it at his wrist, and then takes it and puts it in his mouth, which I think is a terrible idea.
Absolutely.
A terrible idea.
Absolutely.
So then he turns the saw blade on, cuts out of that, and he's good to go. He swings at Whisper, knocks Whisper into a tiny rocket.
Poor Whisper.
By the way, I just want to say... I love that the idea of a villain lair with a monorail is often explored.
Yeah. He puts Whisper in that rocket, and then we never see Whisper again. Whisper doesn't die, presumably.
No, Whisper's
he
in the
should
rocket.
Have been sitting on the front
just
of
hanging
that train.
Out in the rocket. Oh, that would have been great.
God,
just quietly laughing.
Choo choo.
Now you finally can talk normally again.
Pardon me, boys. It's the Chattanooga choo choo.
Your Whisper is very, very similar to your to your Peter, what's his name? Fuck, the director of Dr. No.
Oh, no, Lawrence Gilbert from the director
yes,
of...
Yes, Lawrence Gilbert, yes.
It's very, very important that we have a quiet on set. And you see,
is that what that guy sounds like?
He's English, you know, but he can't say his R's. When we were doing Moonwalker... He's adorable.
I bet he is.
He really is. He really is adorable. James Bond then swings off of this thing, kicks him, knocks him into the rocket ship. Then he's got to deal with Kananga.
Mm-hmm.
Then we see that knife fight situation.
Awesome, nice fight.
And then they take him into the water. Yeah. They take him into the water. You're like, oh my God, there's sharks in there. Something bad's going to happen to somebody. And something bad certainly does happen to Kananga.
Mm-hmm.
Because James somehow removes the capsule from his mouth, sets it off in... Kananga.
Yeah. What is he? Did he put it in his mouth?
Yeah. How does it happen? It
doesn't... I guess. I guess.
Here, swallow this.
Now you're underwater, so you're probably not going to want to open your mouth to let the air out.
Is that really what it is?
Right? I mean, it has to be. There's no reason.
It really, this whole sequence, once they get to that place, just seems so hurriedly thrown together. Like, he gets it in his mouth and he blows up.
Turns out we spent our entire budget on this boat chase.
And this balloon.
You
want to
wrap this up quick?
How did he get free? There's a saw on the watch. Look, what do you want from me?
God. Yeah, so then Kananga blows up like a balloon.
Yeah.
Just like a balloon.
So I have a theory about this, that they only had one take, and it didn't look great. So they post-production zoom in. That's why it gets so grainy, because they don't want you to see the whole thing and just how horrible it looks. Yeah, Plus, it's like a sped-up zoom.
I would love to see some behind-the-scenes.
There is a picture of it. Someone... Did I send
yes,
to you?
Yes, you sent that to me.
Yeah, I'll try to find it. Yeah.
It's an amazing picture of the Kananga balloon just sitting there on the set.
Kananga balloon.
That's great. So
musical guest Kananga Balloon,
Lorraine Newman,
Denitra Vance. Lorraine Newman's gonna be on my Sketchfest show.
Oh, really?
Oh, that's great.
On the Saturday the 8th, 10 p.m. at the Eureka. Yeah, it's gonna be fun.
That was a fun show.
It was a fun show.
I
you
got
did
to
the
participate
original.
In that.
Oh my goodness! He's showing me the picture.
Let me see. I want to see again.
Who sent this to me?
Yeah,
someone sent this.
It's so good.
Oh my goodness.
It's so
That's
crazy.
Insane.
So crazy. Also, can I say Kananga has a very good look.
Yeah,
I
does.
Like his.
He does. He likes the tailoring is impeccable.
Yeah, with like the white ascot and everything. It's a very cool, stylish
look. And he's
look.
Sipping champagne when he does that thing a lot of Bond villains do. Like, you've upset me so much. But in the end, I'm just going to be great to you. I'm going to be buddy, be real hospitable the way I can.
Whisper,
you.
Two more glasses of champagne.
No reason we can't be civilized about this. I run a drug empire. I believe in voodoo.
So after Kananga explodes from air, you think, we've taken care of everything.
That's right. No loose ends.
No. Heroin Farm has been blown up. We're great. Everything's good. Let's head to a train station.
Mm-hmm.
Felix is there. Felix asks the silliest question. What are you going to do on a train for 16 hours? He knows the answer. He knows the answer.
We're going to have sex in the most comfortable setting imaginable. A cross-country train trip.
So this is now, of course, this is in the great tradition of James Bond train fights. We
James
see
James Bond train fights.
James Bond. Oh,
the clapper.
Just one. Teehee has stowed himself away in a bag. I feel like he could have bought a ticket. All right. Anyway, he stowed himself away in a bag.
Suspicious.
It was a different time. Matt. A different
sure.
time.
Sure. You're right. You're right.
He had a hook.
So then we get a little train fight where we see that the hook is just essentially just a system of police.
It is.
And more odd is why is that Solitaire's little vanity case that she has wire cutters in there? Those are not nail clippers. Those are straight up. And she's got a couple of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Just in case.
But it is like a petite little quilted suitcase with little spots for wire cutters.
Right. It's a pretty great fight. And that the snipping of those wires is pretty great.
Yeah.
But exactly. Why are they there? Why are they so close at hand?
Well, aren't they there because they're supposedly connected to his muscles? Like that's
No. Why are the wire cutters?
Oh, sorry.
The vanity case is full of wire cutters.
Yeah. And also there's a cameraman in the window. Did you guys catch that?
No.
Yeah, right before he throws him out, there's just a guy back there. Standing like that.
Just trying to remain still.
Yeah, basically like
please don't see me.
Print. We don't want to take the time to let's just be real still.
Yeah, it's like, did they shoot the movie in real time? And then towards the end, they're like, oh, this is, guys, we're almost out of time here.
But Bond movies are batting 1,000 for train fights, right? I mean,
yeah. They're great. I thought the train fight was great. I liked
great train fight.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel like.
Because the Jaws one in Spy Who Loved Me is pretty good, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he can't pull.
Do you know what? I was forgetting. Like, I forgot that there was a train fight with Jaws.
Yeah.
And so while I'm watching the thing with Teehee, I'm like, oh, when does he hit him with the lamp?
Oh,
when
yeah.
does he do the lamp? He shocks him. And it never happened. I was like, did I make that up?
That's two movies after this. It does seem a little soon to go back to that. especially. Yeah. That's, isn't that an end fight as well? No, it's not. Never mind. Whoa.
Take a bath.
I think I will. All right, he throws Teehee out.
Throws Teehee out.
His arms hang in there.
And then...
what are you doing? Just being disarming, darling.
Yeah. Really.
She is unaware.
The puns are not good.
No. She is unaware this fight has happened.
Mm. Yeah.
She just thinks it was a not very funny joke James did.
She yeah, because those once you close in one of those beds... which have ample room for a human being to be folded inside. They're soundproof.
Yep.
They've made them soundproof.
No chance of her hearing the fight that where walls are broken, glass is shattered.
Yeah. I think the idea was if you accidentally got shut up in one of those things, it was to spare the feelings of the person who's trapped inside. in case people were talking about them,
right?
Thinking they're not in the room.
It's the most...
I want to say what I really feel about solitaire.
Well, there was a big campaign in the 70s of don't go in abandoned refrigerators or train car beds.
That's right.
Train car beds. Yeah, so then I guess they live happily ever after.
Well, until he's never talks to her again.
Yeah. At hour 17.
This is the second novel, so he's still getting over Vesper in this book.
Is it really? Yeah. Oh, I didn't realize that.
And, yeah, you the other thing... Yeah, nothing worth mentioning. It's about Soviet pirate gold in the novel. That's what Mr. Big is smuggling.
Wow.
It's not drugs so much, if I remember correctly.
Soviet pirate gold. Yeah. One or the other.
Something. He's working with the Soviets.
I need some sort of object for them. What am I writing on? Oh, a gold typewriter. Let's put it in the hands of the Soviet pirates.
Did he start off with the gold typewriter?
No. He got big and then he was like, yeah.
He got big and then he changed.
Yeah.
Kananga balloon big?
We did it, guys.
Live and let die.
We're soundly in the Roger Moore. We're approaching it from both sides. We got a couple of Daltons.
We got a couple of Daltons to get through. Yeah. We got some Welsh.
Yeah.
Some Welsh.
You don't like Dalton? I guess we'll find out next week.
It's my least, those are my least visited movies.
Oh. Well, I think you're in for a treat.
I don't know that I've seen, I think I've seen one of them. How many did he do?
Two, three?
Two.
Two.
Wow, only two.
Yeah.
Living Daylights.
The one with Cary Lowell. I saw that one.
Oh, that's License to Kill. Yeah.
Don't remember a lot about it.
Living Daylights is Olivia Diabo.
Yeah. So we will try to be back next week, but no, you know, it could be a week.
You know what? If you expect these every other week,
that's a better way to expect. Plus, it prolongs it because this eventually will end, and then that way we'll have more time together.
I believe
everyone.
That's why we agreed to do it because it's eventually going to end.
Yeah. Also, if you have podcast scheduling expectations. Go fuck yourself.
Seriously, this is a thing that we do. Honestly, I don't know why we do it, but we do it. And we make podcasts.
And we enjoy it.
And they're free. And we're not getting paid. And this is just for you to enjoy. Just enjoy it. Don't be a dick about enjoying it.
Take a look around the world and see the things that are worth complaining about.
Yes.
And agitating.
What if they do and they still come back to that?
Well, they will. They absolutely will.
I revisited all the problems in the world and I just came back around to podcasts.
Everything else checks out just fine.
This is just speaking to the vocal minority that we've come up against lately. Most of you guys are treasured lovers.
Yeah. And we appreciate it. Thank you for
most
listening
people
to
are
our
normal.
Podcast.
Yeah.
If you're complaining about podcast frequency, I cannot say this strongly enough, go fuck yourself.
Yeah. If you've done that, this is for you. If you haven't,
then keep me and you.
Yeah,
keep
you're
in
great.
Keep being a wonderful
You do you.
Yeah.
You do you, we do us. Paul, do you have anything you'd like to promote? This comes out Thursday.
Yes, I'll be bringing a new version of my variety show to Largo at the Coronet.
Excellent.
March 29th. It's called Varietopia with Paul F. Tompkins. Tickets are on sale now, and I think it might almost be sold out actually without me really promoting it much at all.
That's great.
But if you check Largo's website, you could buy some for the next month.
You absolutely may. Yeah. You can see all my live dates at paulftompkins.com/live.
Matt, do you have anything you'd like to promote?
Just really working hard on my universal remote, so I'm thinking in a couple days that's going to be ready to go.
Oh, my God.
Probably looking at 6 to 7 baths in the next week.
Nice.
And maybe 1 to 2 Valencia orange refreshers per day if it's a good week.
You know what? I bet you go orange Valencia crazy, and you end up drowning that universal remote in the bathtub.
No,
there are worse ways
Orange
to go.
Orange Valencia Fever. If you're in San Francisco this weekend, I'll be at Sketchfest February 7th at the Merchant Marine Theater for a Nerdist Podcast Live. I think that's sold out. There's still some tickets left for the Eureka Theater at 10 p.m. on Saturday.
That, let me say, One Star is a great show. It is not to be missed.
Thank you, Paul. It's just go ahead and look at the description. Oh, whatever. I'll tell you.
Yeah.
It's dramatic readings of one-star Yelp reviews from the Koreatown 24-Hour Fitness framed around a Civil War theme.
Yeah. Apparently the most disgusting gym in America.
Is that the most high-concept show ever done?
It might be, because I play the ghost of Ulysses S. Grant, mm-hmm. and Tom Lennon plays the ghost of an unknown Civil War soldier who might be a reenactor. We're not sure.
Oh, wow.
Also, there will be a live band with a period musician.
Ooh,
pieces.
Oh, really? Oh, yes. My God.
And it's going to be a lot of fun. Lorraine Newman's going to be there.
Lorraine Newman, Doug Benson, Jonah Ray.
It's going to be a lot of fun. Please come see it.
Julia Lulia Drivers.
She won't be there.
Musical guest, a fiddle guy. with a short film by Vladimir Putin.
Katie, do you think that this is officially longer than the movie was? Because the movie was 2 hours long.
It's always long with me. I apologize.
It's like just about the same.
Nice.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Hey, okay. Hit
We're
play
back,
and watch
everybody.
The movie.
There you
We're
go.
Back. We're
Dead.
Back. James
back.
Bonding will We're return back. In
License to.
You've got a license to kill. Boom, boom. And wow. I don't remember straight to my heart. What is the line?
I don't even remember the song. That's how infrequently I've watched that movie.
This shouldn't still be going on, right?
Yeah, it really should stop. I gotta go talk over the Super Bowl for 5 hours.
Ear dynamite.
Now leaving Nerdist.com.